MyFantasySportsTalk.com.
Last week on My Fantasy Podcast,
Dan didn't hear me when I said Butler beat Villanova twice this year.
Well, I mean, you can't put too much of the fault on Dan. You know, Dan's a little under the influence at the moment. So I'll go ahead and get on that. So next week when he's a little bit more cautioned, you know, maybe we could reminisce about this and see what he has to say.
Go to sleep tonight with the name Keon Johnson in your head.
But I'll go to sleep with the name Keon Dooling in my head tonight. It doesn't matter. Winthrop is not beating Butler, okay? Winthrop hadn't played anything close to the level of basketball that Villanova plays, and Butler played with them and beat them. How many times have the Patriots and Bill Belichick done this? Randy Moss, okay? Y'all are worried about Brandon Cooks being a disruption in the locker room?
Well, that's Randy what I'm Moss? Saying. So Randy Moss, he had a great year in New England. You didn't give up a first and a third for him. You gave up, I think it was a fourth-round draft pick for Randy Moss, and now you're giving up a first and a third for Cooks. And I'll take Moss 10 times out of 10 over Brandon Cooks. They don't even stand on the same level.
Yeah, well, what I'm saying is I'm not worried about the picks at all. You got a proven commodity, one of the top three receivers in the NFL the past 2 years. That's what the numbers I'm telling you. So I'll take that all day long. But you see what you started, doo-wop? You know, you just sound like a little itty to me now. You got us all fired up. But great question, Noah doo-wop Tucker. We got to move on.
I like this, Dan. Just saying it out there. Just whatever's on his mind, just let it out.
Sure. He's going to ride off into the daylight.
Okay. We got to have that censorship just in case, but go ahead, Dan.
Well, and then again, you know, you got to remember Dan's a little woo-woo. So maybe he don't mean all this for real. What up, podcast peeps? Your boys are back. It's that time again. It's that time every week for you to grab that drink, grab that pad, grab that pen. My Fantasy Podcast about to begin. Thanks for clicking. Thanks for listening. Thanks for watching. We appreciate it. We really do. Let's kind of review the rundown for today's show, which you will enjoy thoroughly, I promise you. But a lot of tournament talk to recap today. Thank you for submitting those tournament questions. We appreciate those. We will answer them on today's show before giving you our Sweet 16 predictions. We're also going to talk NBA today, take a look at the current playoff seedings, and update you on what's going on in the MyFantasySportsTalk.com playoffs. In our fantasy league, we're in the semifinals. Big stuff going on there. A couple of close games. We'll see who makes the championship. But also have some great mailbag questions for you today that may or may not involve LaVar Ball. Why are we even talking about this dude so much, man? I don't know. It's just like addicting, you know? The more he won't shut up, the more we have to keep talking about it. It's crazy, but we'll debate that once again, and also debate once again, who is the NBA MVP? I'm not sure we've really settled it. So that will be a lot of fun, too. And before we go, we'll hit on NFL news, free agent signings, talk about how Donald Trump is affecting the next 2017 NFL season, in case you didn't know. Of course, you know, we're going to have some great mailbag questions for you submitted to us by you, the viewers. So I appreciate that. And all you listeners and watchers of My Fantasy Podcast. So, man, I guess let's just do it. Let's get into it. I am Brandon Reed, lead writer for MyFantasySportsTalk.com. Let me introduce that guy that keeps on coming in number two whenever he faces me in any kind of competitive competition. But number two is not bad. And that number two coming in second in debates against me also includes that Brandon Cooks debate last week on the podcast. In case you didn't miss it, or in case you missed it, go back and check it out. But he is our founder, so I respect thee. He's our president. He's our editor-in-chief. He has two pets, Des the kitty and Romo the dog. He hails from the greater Buffalo area. He is Dan the Man Shaw. And the first thing I got to say is, Dan, right there in your own backyard, Buffalo screwed everybody's bracket.
Yeah, yeah, it was definitely a exciting couple of games in Buffalo. Obviously, number one overall seed Villanova goes down on Saturday. Here, it was pretty crazy scene downtown at the Key Bank Center where the game was. So exciting to see. Not very happy with the outcome. Obviously, I had Villanova in our bracket taking home the championship again, and that obviously did not work out too well. But Wisconsin's a tough matchup, and that was a matchup that was scary to me. So it's tough. You know, it looked like Villanova could have had it, but ultimately they fell, and you got to respect Wisconsin. They're filled with leaders all around, if you ask me, and the Big Ben ultimately caused the game to swing, in my opinion.
Yeah, and I guess I didn't even really realize. I watched a little bit of, you know, I like Big Ten basketball. I watched a little bit of Wisconsin this year, but I know no more Bo Bryan. Greg Gard's doing a great job, though, but I didn't even realize Bronson Koenig still played on the team. So, you know, you got a really good team there. So, you know, let me kind of stick to that theme there. Did you run into any of your fans, your number one fans from Kenosha, Wisconsin, in Buffalo over the weekend?
Kenosha, Wisconsin?
Yeah, where all your number one fans are from.
They are?
Yeah, we've talked about this on the podcast before. Don't you remember, Orlando?
Well, I guess I must have just forgotten, because I Kenosha was cats. Oh, cheese? Something with cheese?
I get it. You were under the influence that day, too. You totally don't remember that, huh? Okay.
So disrespectful to them. So disrespectful.
Yeah.
My apologies.
I can't believe you don't remember that.
I don't remember people from Kenosha, Wisconsin. They're my fans.
We talked about this on the podcast.
Your inbox is about to blow up with hate mail.
Yeah, we've talked about this before, Dan. Now, okay, you're tossing all your Wisconsin fans aside when they're still in the tournament. Go figure. Dan, the back must not be fully healed yet. You still on that dope?
You know, I still have some pain, so I do have some muscle relaxers, possibly still in my system. So, you know, are you talking about like where Wisconsin, the university, is from? Is that what we're talking about?
No, I'm talking about where your fan base is from, Kenosha, Wisconsin. We talked about this on the podcast. We're going to have to move on. We're going to have to move on before you dig a deeper hole with your fans in Kenosha, Wisconsin. You're killing your mother here, Dan. Are you taking the pot?
My mother is from Buffalo, so I don't know what you're talking about.
Orlando members, I'll pull up the clip from several podcasts ago where we talked about your fan base being from Kenosha, Wisconsin.
Man, my apologies, Wisconsin. Love your cheese.
You missed it. You even mentioned that. You missed the boat. You missed the boat. We got to move on. We got to go to San Ann. It's time to bring in our resident actor and thespian. He is a student. He is an actor. He is a father. He works 7 days a week and still finds time to kick it with us on the podcast. That's a lot going on. So we appreciate him for spending the time. Also the face of Toyota, or soon to be. So check him out for that. But he's known on Twitter as Brown Adam Schefter, but known in them streets as Last Place Lando, a.k.a. It's Lando Yo, a.k.a. Zeke Virus, a.k.a. Zeke and Destroy, a.k.a. Team Torres. It is Orlando Torres. And I was talking to you a little bit earlier, but I want you to answer it for the peeps at home. Did your champion pick, your pick as champion in the NCAA tournament, survive the first weekend?
Yes. And they are still going to survive through the second weekend.
Oh, and you must have got lucky, because there's a lot of folks that can't say that right now. Did not survive the first weekend.
Well, hey, after seeing one of the matchups that my pick is going to face the second weekend, gives me even more hope that they're going to pass the second weekend. So I'll say that for right now.
There you go. Don't spoil it all. Don't spoil it all. We're going to get into all that and make all of our picks. One last thing. You know, a week or so ago when we were on the podcast, we were talking about how your Spurs grabbed the number one seed in the West. You know, were they going to keep it? Were they going to try to keep it? What the hell happened? Now you're 2.5 games back just like that.
Because I know them. They do this all the time. And before Dan starts with his Tony Parker jokes,
he was laughing.
this is something we're used to. This Spurs is going to grab the seed, and I told you it's not going to be concerned. So it's going to happen. And I got to give up to your Grizzlies. I mean, 2-0 so far against the Spurs. So I got to give.
Yeah, and on a 5-game winning streak.
And I got to give them, you know, and the Spurs, they put the Spurs in 3-game losing streak. And luckily, they broke that the other day against the Kings. But, I kind of knew they weren't going to hold on to the one seed. That was expected. And even if they hang on to two or grab the one, I mean, it is what it is. There's still a lot of basketball to be played, so I'll leave it at that.
Well, I'm right back there with our number one fans, Nick and Judy Pertens, who asked us a month or so ago, who would you rather face? And I wasn't quite sure. I was actually kind of leaning towards the Rockets. I want to face the Spurs now. At this point in the season, I'm not really fighting for the sixth seed anymore, unless I think we can get the five seed and play Utah in that matchup. But if we can't really realistically grab that, then I would much rather face your San Antonio Spurs in the first round, Orlando.
Oh, Judy was a Spurs fan, right? I wonder how that household gets when
that's gonna be nasty. Yeah,
competitive time. Someone's gonna have to sleep outside or in the doghouse, I'm sure.
Yeah, well, it's gonna be night by night, game by game. We'll see. Yeah. I hope that thing doesn't go 7 games. It may break up a marriage there. That's gonna be tough. But let's get into the show and talk March Madness. You are experiencing My Fantasy Podcast from MyFantasySportsTalk.com. So, March Madness first weekend that just happened. Dan, what'd you think?
Oh man, it was phenomenal. I mean, I watched it from my couch with my muscle relaxers, and we enjoyed every minute of it. I watched as many games as possible all weekend long. So it was something I was knee deep in, and the games were exciting. You know, after Thursday's games, I was like, you know, there's not really many upsets that happened, that are notable. You had Middle Tennessee on Thursday, but other than that, I think most of the lower seeds won. So it wasn't you didn't see as many upsets that first day, but you know, as the tournament obviously went along, we look at where we are now.
You had to open your mouth, didn't you? You had to say something. Guys, go ahead and pull up your brackets. We'll go through them, just kind of the results and surprises real quick. And, of course, we'll start with the East. So let's just start right there in that East where the biggest upset did happen, right there in Dan's own backyard. So you mentioned it, Dan. It was going nuts down there. What did you say? Key Bank? What was the name of the arena there?
Yeah, Key Bank Center. That's the home of the Sabres, so that's where they convert into the basketball arena.
So it was pretty wild. Would you say around town, though, if you were out and about in the bars or, wherever, did you see red? Was there Wisconsin fans? Did they travel very well that you could tell?
Well, I wasn't out at the bar, so I can tell you that much.
I guess you were still ailing, weren't you? Yeah. can't mix the dope and alcohol. You can't.
Yeah,
shouldn't.
I mean, I can speak for experience being at the previous tournament games and, the teams do travel well. I mean, a notable team was Dayton. Last time that they came, I mean, it was unbelievably filled with red from Dayton fans. So I would imagine, Wisconsin's not too far away. Oshkosh or whatever you said.
Kenosha, man. Oh, Kenosha, digging that. Hold it. Digging it deeper. Digging it deeper. I'm going to have to pull up the clip.
It's not that far. It's not that far away, and a lot of like Villanova, Philadelphia. It's an 8-hour drive. So not too bad. So I think it was definitely packed. I mean, the news was loaded with the busyness and how pumped up Buffalo was during this weekend.
Okay, so let's back up, like I said, and talk about just the East bracket in general. Villanova had no problem with Mount St. Mary's. Wisconsin did beat Virginia Tech by 10 in that first round. Virginia squeaked by UNC Wilmington. Thought you had it. UNC Wilmington jumped out to like a 15 or 16-point lead early in the first half, Dan.
Yeah, that was an upsetting game. I watched it from start to finish. I thought Wilmington had, I mean, they basically did have it all the way up until the end. The last few minutes I was – I was confident the entire game up until then, but it was something Virginia that they didn't do against Florida in the second round is they didn't make shots, and they did against Wilmington when they needed to. So you can say maybe it was Florida's defense, but I just think they had a good shooting night, and something lucky that happens every once in a while for that poor offensive team.
And I think you nailed it when we were talking about the preview last week when you weren't buying Virginia. And I could go either way. I could see them, beating UNC Wilmington, which I did picked Virginia to win that, but I never would have guessed they would have only put up 39 points in a second round game. You were so right. That offense stalled. It just stalled. They could have used someone like Austin Nichols, maybe put some more balls in buckets, but that was nasty. So Florida moved on there after beating East Tennessee State, which I predicted. So I missed on that one, whiffed on that one. They just didn't have the athletes. They had a great score in TJ Cromer, but that just wasn't enough. And then in the bottom half of that bracket, USC upset SMU. That's right. You heard me, folks. Much to the dismay of Dan Schalk, USC did pull up off that upset. Baylor cruised past New Mexico State, and South Carolina beat Marquette. Duke handled Troy. So first round games out of the East, Orlando, any surprises, any disappointments? What did you think out of the first round just out of that region?
No, I think, especially with the number ones, I think, you know, you kind of expected that. No disappointments. Looking at it, maybe the SMU and USC game. I think I had picked SMU over USC. But other than that, nothing that's really eye-popping.
Yep, I agree. Except for, you know, the SMU loss. that was fun. That was fun, Dan. Anyway, let's move on to the second round real quick. So right there at the top, Wisconsin did pull off the big upset in Buffalo over Villanova, knock out not just the number one seed in the East, but the number one overall seed. So big surprise, crushed a lot of people's brackets. I noticed in the particular bracket that Dan and I are playing in, I think about half the people in that bracket had Villanova winning it, including our own Dan Schalk. So crushed right there. We mentioned Florida pounded Virginia 65-39. They're moving on. So Florida and Wisconsin will play in the Sweet 16. Baylor beat USC in another really good game. And then South Carolina pulled off the upset. Stunning Duke, number two, who a whole lot of people picked Duke to win the championship as well. So Baylor will meet South Carolina in the Sweet 16. So what do you think about the Sweet 16 matchups out of the East, Dan?
I mean, I love that South Carolina Duke game. I was forced to watch that one, even when I wanted to watch the Rhode Island game. It was so exciting and just, you know, up and down, and the defense that South Carolina played. I knew Frank Martin was that type of coach. You know, he was that type of coach at Kansas State, kind of the pressure type of defense. But, you know, I think it's Sendaris Thornwell. That guy is a baller, man. He can light it up, and he's not usually that good offensively. I've watched a couple games this year, but, you know, in that game in particular, he was lights out.
Well, can I say this? I really think they are blessed because they have experienced players. A lot of experienced junior seniors, and Sedarius Thornwell's been there from the beginning, and he is an outstanding baller, and I do not think they probably wouldn't even be in this tournament if not for him. He didn't play when they played Memphis earlier. Memphis beat them. They're not the same team when he doesn't play, so look out for him. He's definitely one of the top players in the whole tournament, really, to keep an eye out for, but definitely not the same if he ain't balling out.
Yeah, no, it's his defense too that I think sets him apart. You know, you have those great offensive weapons on teams, but you know his defensive play, it sets him a step above. Them against Baylor, Baylor's up and down for me. I'm not too sure how to read them even still. I think they're kind of a tough team to read, I guess you would say. I don't know what type of Baylor team you're always going to get. So I like South Carolina to possibly end up pulling that out. We'll see. But if they can play that type of defense, I don't think Baylor's going to be able to keep up, I guess you would say.
Wow. All right. There you go. We'll talk about our predictions a little bit later. Orlando, are you surprised out of the East? It's not entirely chalk out there.
Well, looking more at the Villanova Wisconsin match, it's not so much as a shock as it came out to be. I know it came out to be like a number one versus number eight seed. I mean, but Wisconsin made it to the second round, what, the past 4 years? I mean, some of the players they have, they're veterans, Hayes and Kinnick, and, you know, they've had some players that have been there and through their grind. So looking at it like that, it's not much a surprise that they beat Nova. You know, some
well, and Greg Gardner was right there with Bo Ryan the whole time too. So it's not like they hired a coach from the outside. He was the intended replacement because Bo Ryan wasn't exactly a spring chicken. So this was kind of a plan. And actually, you know, I read last year he was actually supposed to take over all of last year, but it was either his mother or his father. I'm sorry, I remember. I think it was his father. Maybe he was in real bad health and ended up passing away. And then after that, then they finally kind of passed the torch, but that's the only reason they didn't want to give him the job right off the bat for last year's because I think it was his father was not in great health at that time. So Bo Ryan agreed to kind of stick it through until, you know, not needed anymore.
Right. And looking back at it, I mean, it was projected what Big East champs versus the Big Ten champs. So, I mean, you know, this was a big matchup. It's not too much of a shock breaking, you know, looking at it now. But Duke, I mean, that was a bit of a shock because I know even South Carolina coming in at 7 was a bit, you know, questionable to some people, you know, and Duke was a Vegas favorite odd to win it all. And with South Carolina, I thought that was a game that Duke could win. But once it got closer to the ending, the ending of the game, I felt like, oh, no, so, you know, South Carolina is really going to pull it off. And I don't think it was the main reason for South Carolina winning, but, you know, I think that they had a bit of a home field advantage, the fact that the game was played in South Carolina. But that overall, Duke losing in the second round, that was a bit of a shock. I didn't expect that. I thought they would have got past. They would have made it to the second round. I'm sorry, lost in the first round.
Yeah, and I don't think the committee really thought it would have been that big of an advantage for South Carolina, because I think a lot of people, like myself, probably picked Marquette to even beat South Carolina. So I don't think the committee really thought, well, South Carolina get by and home court advantage may have them upsetting Duke. I think that they just kind of fell into that. Now, I wasn't a believer in Duke. I didn't have them going to the Final Four. But I'll tell you what really kind of broke up a lot of my bracket here so far in the first weekend was my disrespect of the SEC. It bit me several times in the first round. Let's move on to the West. We'll go straight down and into that West where the wild, wild West number one seed is Gonzaga. The Bulldogs took care of South Dakota State in the first round. Northwestern did beat Vanderbilt in that battle of the nerdy schools. Yeah, Northwestern just a little bit better that day playing the old ball there on the hard court. And Notre Dame beat Princeton by 2. Good game there. West Virginia beat Bucknell. Moving down even further into the bottom half of that bracket, Xavier, who knew? Who knew? Edmund Sumner, who? Xavier moves on, beats Maryland in the first round. Florida State does beat Florida Gulf Coast. St. Mary's beat VCU, and Arizona beat North Dakota. So, out of the first round, Dan, any surprises at all? As Xavier, maybe? Did you have Xavier?
No. I thought after they lost, you know, Sumner, like you said, and even before that, they lost Miles Davis. So they lost their top two players, halfway through the year. So they almost didn't make the tournament. A win over, I think it was Butler in their conference tournament, kind of sealed their fate to get in. But I love them. I watched a lot of Xavier games this year. I liked watching. They were a good team, but when they lost Sumner, they lost part of themselves. So it was good to see, you know, they got some shooters like JP McCura. You know, he can always make the three and in the tournament, if you can get hot, like he was able to a little bit, you can definitely make things happen. So they're a dangerous team. They always seem to be in this spot, you know, Xavier in the Sweet 16, it's not something out of the ordinary. So it was good to see, but you know, the biggest thing out of this bracket that I wanted to give a shout out to is our homie Julia Louis-Dreyfus with Northwestern. I don't know if you caught her at the Northwestern games, but she was in the Northwestern cheering section, and the camera loved her, and it was great to see her, cheering, having a good time, rooting for her Wildcats. And they kind of got robbed against Gonzaga in that second round game with the missed goaltend call and then the tee on Chris Collins. So it's tough to see. I would have liked to see Northwestern advance in their first tournament ever. I wanted to see Julia Louis-Dreyfus happy. So
there's a lot of Northwestern's alum just in the TV business and sports business, you know, alone. You know, of course, everyone, one of the more famous ones is Mike Greenberg, you know, from Mike and Mike, and Cassidy Hubbard, who covers NBA on ESPN, Northwestern. Yep. And Wilbon. Yep. So a lot of folks right there in the ESPN mothership from what, but it's a great journalism school. It's one of the, I guess maybe the top journalism school, I assume. But yeah. So, but they got a win. They did get a win over Vanderbilt. That's something they can say. If they never make the tournament again, they can say they made the first tournament and beat Vanderbilt and, in the first round. So, Orlando, what about that first round out in the Wild Wild West?
Yeah, well, looking at the 6-11 matchup, Maryland and Xavier, I got that impression that Maryland was expected to win, but don't be shocked or don't take it as a surprise. Xavier came out on top. And how about Notre Dame barely getting by Princeton by 2 points? I know that was a game we had talked about, a 5-12 matchup. There was a lot of people saying that Princeton could probably knock them off, but that Notre Dame should be able to handle them with no problem. So I thought Notre Dame was going to be able to win by at least 10, and the fact that they survived by two, I mean, that was the only game they won, but if anything, everything else is pretty right. But other than that, I thought Notre Dame would have handled Princeton a lot better than what they did.
Yep, closer than I thought it was going to be. So Gonzaga, we talked about Gonzaga did beat Northwestern. West Virginia did beat Notre Dame. Xavier and Trayvon Blewett, I think, Dan, is the leading scorer in the tournament so far. He's got to be close. He's got 50 points in two games.
Yeah.
So they're putting up points. They're looking good. And again, I guess I really disrespect him because you talked about the loss of Davis. Edmund Sumner, I guess I just kind of wrote them off a little bit, man, but Trayvon Blewett is just putting them on his back, and they're rolling. They're a good team. So they beat Florida State, which I had going pretty far. And then Arizona beat St. Mary's. So let's move on and talk about, we'll get into our predictions a little bit later. That's just kind of going through the results right now of what happened in that first round, shocks and surprises and recap and everything. So let's move up and over to the Midwest. First round games, Kansas did beat UC Davis. Michigan State, there goes Tom Izzo again, just doing what he does in March. They beat Miami in the first round. Iowa State did beat Nevada. Sorry, Dustin. We tried to tell you it wasn't even really, really a close game there, but I like Nevada a lot. You're gonna be fine there, just not this year against a hot Iowa State team. Purdue did beat Vermont. Sorry, Dan. Rhode Island though, you got one with Rhode Island. Rhode Island beat Creighton. Oregon did beat Iona. Michigan, one of the hottest teams in the land right now, did beat Oklahoma State in a very close game. Louisville survived Jacksonville State. So sorry to our listener who posed that question and posed that upset potential last week. Did not happen. Dan, in the Midwest, any surprises there?
No, not really. I mean, it all pretty well served from what I had. This was my best region. I got everyone in the first round right, which was good to see. Michigan State, I thought they scared me a little bit because they were down by like 14 points in the first 10 minutes and they ended up winning by 20. So that was pretty impressive to see that type of turnaround. I was really high on Rhode Island. I thought I had them in the Elite Eight. I thought they were really going to be a solid team. And they just fell short in the second round.
Almost got a chance.
Yeah, I mean, basically, if it wasn't until the end, I mean, Tyler Dorsey kind of took over for Oregon in the second round, but I had Rhode Island going very far. Purdue, I think, was the class of the bracket. I have them in my Final Four. But Kansas looks possibly like the most dangerous team in this tournament, the way they played in the first two rounds. I mean, it's been dominant.
Yep.
Josh Jackson, I got to tell you, I've watched a lot of college basketball. I still think Markelle Fultz is by far and away going to be the number one pick in the draft. But Josh Jackson, man, he's got such a smooth stroke. He's just a shooter. I love his game, and I think it's going to translate pretty quickly to the NBA next year.
Wow. So Dan's already giving you draft coverage of the NBA. There you go. That's why you got to click and listen and watch. Ain't that right, Orlando?
That's exactly right.
Talk about the Midwest, Orlando. Any surprises? Anything just kill your bracket or everything kind of fall to chalk there the way you see it?
No, I think everything fell to chalk on me, but that Oregon-Rhode Island game was pretty good. And I think, if Tyler Dorsey didn't drop, I think it was 27 points. I mean, we might be talking about Rhode Island still. I mean, other than that, I think everything fell into the way we predicted.
So Dan just kind of gave it away, predicting Purdue to go to the Final Four. But I would
Maybe not now. I did.
No. We'll talk about it later. I got you. We'll talk about it later. It's very interesting now, the way it's set up for you. It's pulling at your heartstrings, I know. So, we'll save it for later, though, Dan, because I know exactly what you want to talk about.
Okay, good. Well, we'll save it for later, then.
Got it.
Mark down.
Okay, we're on a time schedule here, okay, Dan?
Five more minutes, we'll get to it.
We've got 2 hours here. Anyway, let's go through the South real quick. North Carolina beat Texas Southern. Arkansas did beat Seton Hall again. My disrespect of the SEC bit me again. It happened right there. Middle Tennessee, much to the surprise of not many who picked Middle Tennessee, did beat Minnesota. Butler beat Winthrop. Sorry, Dan. Cincinnati beat Kansas State.
Hello.
I was waiting for it. Yep. UCLA beat Kent State. Wichita State, to the surprise of not many, beat Dayton. And Kentucky beat North Kentucky. So what happened out in the South, Dan?
I mean, Cincinnati was dominant in their first round game. I think that was pretty clear. It was, you know, they ran into Lonzo Ball, man. And just like Josh Jackson, Lonzo Ball is smooth. People are calling him the next Magic Johnson. And against Cincinnati, I mean, he just some of the just the way he moves, it looks so effortless when he's out on the court. And that's something you don't see often. I mean, he's just gliding. And, you know, we're going to be talking about Pops LeVar in a bit, but he's got to be proud of his kid right now because I sure would. And UCLA is a dangerous team the way they've played and the way they look. So I was surprised to actually see that because obviously I had Cincinnati knocking them off in the second round.
They move and shoot the ball so well.
Yeah. Yeah, and they have shooters, you know, at all the positions. I know Lonzo's got the funkiest stroke I've ever seen, but you know, it's effective.
He jacks it. It's a true jack.
Yeah, it's odd. But then just looking at some of the other ones, you know, I had Arkansas. I loved that UNC Arkansas game. That was a great one to watch.
Almost crushed my bracket. I may not have watched any more after that if Arkansas would have won.
I was hoping so bad too, because you know, in the bracket that we're in, it's basically scraps are left. So you know, every round UNC advances, it hurts my hopes. Arkansas, their defense was similar to South Carolina's, just absolutely dominant. So you know, that was a good game. And Middle Tennessee, they just drove past Minnesota. I thought they would give Butler more of a run than what they did, and sadly. Give props to Orlando because I did not have Butler even winning their first round game. And here they are in the Sweet 16.
And looking good. Orlando, yep. Your show dog. What's up in the South?
As far as the games, I think everything's pretty much went to place. Except I did have Seton Hall over Arkansas. Yeah, I mean, Arkansas did give North Carolina a good run for their money. Looking at that, Cincinnati's looking good. UCLA, they're going to be a top pick. Between them and Butler, and that, you know, coming out of that, I think to make it to the Final Four, I don't want to give too much away. Wichita State beating Dayton, I thought they would have gave Kentucky. That was a close game. I was on the edge about picking Wichita State over in the second round over that, and that didn't happen. But other than that, everything fell into place.
Yep. A lot of lucky folks in Memphis, Tennessee, going to get to see a lot of good basketball with North Carolina taking on. It's pretty much the Battle of the Blue Bloods right there in the home of the Blues there. Memphis, Tennessee, North Carolina, Butler, and UCLA, Kentucky. Some really good basketball there. And Calipari finally returns to Memphis. That's going to be interesting. So that's the recap of the first round and the second round in the NCAA tournament. What a first weekend of basketball. Never goes the way you think it's going to, but that was it in a nutshell. I'll tell you what, let's go ahead and answer some mailbag questions and give our predictions next. You're listening to and watching My Fantasy Podcast from MyFantasySportsTalk.com. Brandon Reed, Dan Schalk, and Orlando Torres here. Got some really good questions this week, so let's just go and get into them. What's on your mind is what you really want to know. So first one comes from Gail Perkins. How are your brackets doing, guys? Any pick that you're proud of? Mine is Xavier in the Sweet 16. I actually have them in the Elite 8. So let's progress it even further. So Gail Perkins says she's proud of Xavier. Who are you proud of, Dan? Besides Cincinnati. Don't even say Cincinnati.
It's tough because a lot of my upsets that I picked are no longer in the tournament. So, you know, I'll go out of a bracket that I did outside of our league. I actually did have Wisconsin beating Villanova. I kind of did that just as an insurance bracket to my Villanova pick. So I guess I can give myself a little bit of props there, but not really. But I guess the other one is just West Virginia. The way they've looked, I have West Virginia in our bracket in the Final Four. I think they're a dangerous team. Obviously, you can tell I like those teams that play that aggressive defense. And they've looked impressive in their two wins. And I think they're going to give Gonzaga a run for their money. So, you know, I guess that would be a pick because I don't really have any other of my upsets. They didn't happen. They didn't come to fruition like your Xavier one there. So props to you because I didn't have any.
Well, in mine, of course, Dan knows about USC beating SMU. I really thought it was going to be USC when I saw that matchup too, that first round or the play-in game anyway. But I just thought SMU could be beat. I just wasn't high on the American Athletic Conference. But then also Rhode Island, Dan got that one as well. Rhode Island's a pretty solid team, and they were primed for an upset there. And almost gave it to Oregon, like Dan said. So Dan was really high on Rhode Island. But I liked all of my South region. The Memphis region was all intact. Didn't miss a game there. Only missed one game in the Midwest region. The East really chewed me up pretty good. But overall, not too bad. I got three of my final four teams in it, and my champion is still in it. So I'll roll with that. Got 11 of the Sweet 16 teams. Not great, but we'll roll with it and see what happens. Orlando, is there anything you're really proud of, or just how's your bracket looking in general?
I think after the Duke loss to South Carolina, it just got derailed. Other than that, some of the picks are probably still intact, and you just stay on topic, I guess, for what I got laughed at. Just Butler getting it out, running it out. I don't think there was any other upsets or anything crazy that I went overboard with looking at the bracket. So as far as I'm proud of, I did like Rhode Island, but again, I did think they would get into some trouble with Oregon, and some of the other matchups just about as right, and probably except with the Nova and Wisconsin, which is close, and again, South Carolina over Duke.
All right. Well, there you go. A few upsets there. I think I kind of feel the same way Dan did, is I picked a few, but it was really kind of just, you know, first round, you know, events. It wasn't anything that we're still talking about in the second weekend. So props to your Xavier pick there. You know, like just for example, like Middle Tennessee, I had them beating Minnesota, but I didn't have them advancing any further than that. The East Tennessee State, which didn't come to fruition, but, you know, I picked that, but I didn't have them going any further than that. USC, the same deal. So I picked a lot of chalk. That's why I'm in a decent position, I guess, to still hang on. Louisville going down hurt a lot of people. Of course, Villanova going down, and Florida State did hurt me a little bit too, out of that West region. So those are just some of the ones that, you know, really kind of hurt me, but don't have any really big Cinderella upset, and there really isn't, I guess. But Xavier is the highest ranked seed still in it, right? Is that correct?
I think so, yeah.
At 11, yeah. So really not any real huge Cinderellas, because even, you know, it's always, you know, 8-9 has always been a toss-up. I think even now 7-10 is a toss-up. And you're getting even to the point where 6-11 with the play-in games and everything, and that being, you know, some of the last four out, those are teams that can really play ball that are getting those 11 seeds. So those are toss-ups to me now too. So, but props. Good job with the Xavier pick. We'll see. Trevor blew it, Gail Perkins. Thanks for submitting the question. Let's move on and talk about the next one. Comes from Anu Vasquez. Must be a fan of yours, Orlando, watching you heavily talking about Butler. Butler looking like a Final Four contender, which is Orlando has been trying to tell us. Must feel good for one of you guys. Right, Orlando? Anu Vasquez, what's up?
Exactly. I've been saying it, and I've been getting the middle finger from the both of you. I'm just kidding. Maybe not as violent.
Not the middle finger.
Yeah. I know.
It's something like that. But
yeah, I mean, Kalon Butler, Andrew, I don't know how you pronounce the last name, Shrez Baz or something like that. I mean, they've been pretty good. I think I don't want to spoil it too much either, but I think after UNC has some trouble, I think, you know, it's going to be an interesting matchup, you know, with Butler heading into to the games on the weekend. So, I mean, I'll leave it at that, and it does feel good to see that they're still going on there and looking like a top contender.
Yep, they are looking good. Here's what I noticed, though, about Butler. Let me see. So their route, so let me find them on my bracket here. I forget where they are, but anyway, they had to play a 13 seed in the first round and a 12 in the second, right? So I think they've definitely had the easiest road so far, and then you know, it's not going to get any easier, but they have had a fairly easy road. So I don't know, Dan, what do you think about Butler? Are they really balling, or do you think they have had a little bit of an easy road?
Yeah, I mean, I definitely think you can speak to their road. I think, you know, props to Butler. You're in the Sweet 16, but you're about to meet North Carolina, and you can say goodnight to your tournament lives there, because I don't think you're getting past North Carolina. It's just the style of play. I just don't – there's too many athletes, you know, on North Carolina. You look at a team that Butler can beat, like Villanova. They kind of match up pretty well with Villanova. They, you know, size-wise throughout – maybe even a little bit bigger than Villanova, because Villanova doesn't really have that true center like the Bulldogs do. So, you know, I props to them, but I think they're going to be hurting in this next round.
Yeah. I mean, I like the pick. I like Butler, but they may be a little bit in over their heads right now. But after seeing the way Arkansas gave North Carolina fits, that does give Butler fans a little bit of a hope that maybe they could come into Memphis and knock off the number one seed, UNC. But, I mean, good luck beating North Carolina, and then most likely, I think, UCLA to make the Final Four. That's going to be tough. So, but appreciate the question, Anu Vasquez. Is that one of your friends, Orlando?
I have no idea who that is, but I appreciate the shout-out from Vasquez.
Yeah, trying to prop you up here.
Where are they from? Send me more.
That I don't know.
We don't have their profile.
Are they from Kenosha?
No. No, they're going to be daring to up until next week when he's lost all recollection of even having
his. He's going to be asking for us to throw the rope in the hole that he's in.
I still don't know.
I'm going to play the clip for you, Dan. I'm going to find the clip, edit it out. And we talked about this. We talked about this weeks ago. And now you just lost fans. You burned bridges.
I've been watching too much game film. I think they'll forgive me.
No, I do agree with that. You've been watching a lot, and over 100 draft profiles is my brain would be mush too. Not even considering all the other things that are going on, like March Madness, and I know baseball's kicking up. You ain't even talking anything about the World Bank.
The U.S. is playing tonight. I know our podcast will be airing afterwards, so we'll find out if they make it to the finals. But you know, baseball season coming up, I'm excited for it. So you know, we're gonna make sure we squeeze a little baseball talk in here and there, so some of our listeners can be happy.
Yep. Hey, you got to give everybody what they're looking for. You know who else is playing tonight? Georgia Tech. All right, let's move on to our next question from Kyle Washington. What Sweet 16 matchup are you most looking forward to? Well, I mean, I'll go ahead and real quick, all of them. We're in the Sweet 16 now. It's all of them. They're all going to be good matchups now. I think we've got to the point now where there's so much parity in basketball. When you get to the second round, anybody can beat anybody. Like we saw Wisconsin as an 8 seed. That's a pretty good team at an 8 seed. So and it, once you get past that first round, I mean, of course, you can have blowouts like what Florida did to Virginia, but I mean, I didn't really see that coming. But anyway, that's kind of an exception, not the rule. But But I do mostly want to see the South region in Memphis, of course, UCLA and Kentucky. I think that's really a title game. I was really disappointed when the committee put both UCLA and North Carolina in the same bracket because I probably would have had them meeting in the championship if it would have worked out like that. So I think that's a title game, caliber type game. But can Butler knock off North Carolina? We'll see. I'm watching all the number one seeds, see if Gonzaga can take care of West Virginia. Can Kansas survive Purdue? I know Dan doesn't think so, and I don't really know. I think Kansas is playing the best of anybody through the first two rounds, but Purdue is primed for an upset, and Purdue is solid. Purdue has some things that you can't match up very well with, just plain and simple. And did Oregon get a break when they got Michigan and drew Michigan instead of Louisville? Who's going to win the East? Is it going to be a surprise? I don't know. I think no matter who, unless Baylor wins this thing, I think it's going to be, or I guess Baylor's probably even the favorite now, but I don't know. It's going to be I'm looking at all these matchups, and they're all intriguing to me. Orlando, what do you think?
Is this a prediction part now, or just
What are you most looking forward to out of the Sweet 16?
Exactly. I think it's all the games, and I think one of them that stands out is the Oregon and Michigan game. If I'm looking forward to, because Michigan's one of the hottest teams right now, and Oregon as well. I mean, besides Tyler Dorsey, I mean, they have some pretty good playmakers. They're in the backcourt. So I think that's one of the more intriguing matchups I'm looking at. And the same thing, just to bite off you, the Kentucky and UCLA game. I mean, that's potential. It's a shame that, you know, we're seeing this matchup in a Sweet 16, but it is what it is. And I think that even though it's a shame and a lot of people feel that way, I just think it builds it up for the game in Sweet 16. I mean, it's going to be a highly anticipated game. So if we're seeing what could have been a championship game in a Sweet 16, I'm sure it's going to be, you know, from beginning to end, just an all-out battle.
Yeah, and that's really fortunate for folks in Memphis who are getting. I mean, I really like that region as far as the matchups and the teams you're getting to see more than any other regions by far. Because I mean, the Blue Bloods, like I said, that is the region of the Blue Bloods. Dan, what are you looking forward to in that Sweet 16?
Yeah, I think it definitely has to be UCLA in Kentucky in that Sweet 16 matchup. That's the number one on my list. Obviously, I'm going to be watching the Purdue-Kansas one. Purdue, my hopes on my bracket are kind of riding on them. I think it's going to be a heck of a game. It's going to be close. It'll be interesting to see if they can pull it off, but that's one I'll be looking forward to. And then another one is just Gonzaga-West Virginia. You know, another one of my picks, West Virginia. I want to see if they can shut down Gonzaga. They looked definitely mediocre at times against Northwestern. So if West Virginia can take advantage where Northwestern maybe couldn't have against them, could provide a win for the Mountaineers.
Yeah. It's going to be tough. I'm still on that Gonzaga bandwagon. I really am. So we'll see what happens. But, I mean, wouldn't you agree, Dan, that once you get to this point, I mean, you're not really looking at any – there's no upsets. No one could possibly win a game here in the Sweet 16 and be considered Cinderella or an upset this particular year.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think the field is pretty solid right now. I mean, I think some games are more intriguing than others. Like, I can tell you for one, that South Carolina-Baylor game, that's – if I'm busy, I'm busy for that game. That doesn't matter too much to me because I don't think either team are really going to be a factor, moving forward. I don't think they, you know, it's tough in that region because there's not a whole lot of, you know, great teams, I guess you would say. But, that UCLA-Kentucky one, I think that's by far and away, like you said, the Blue Bloods college basketball. How many championships do they have between them? Just the legacies of both programs meeting up. And you have how many first-round picks in that game? Coming into the draft next season, it's going to be mind-blowingly talented. I can only imagine how many scouts are going to be at that game because they're going to fill it.
I was just thinking the same exact thing that it press row is going to be. And I guess that's why we couldn't get in, Dan. We tried to get in. We tried to get in with media credentials. We were denied because only top level, there's only so much room and everybody wants a ticket to that show.
Yeah, and especially now when you look at the matchups. I mean, we did it before we knew was even going there. So it definitely would have been if once those seedings came out and you saw those types of teams, that bracket alone at North Carolina, UCLA, Kentucky, 1, 2, 3. I mean, it's mind-blowing how deep that one bracket is.
And like I said before, with the return of Calipari to the Memphis area and return to the FedEx Forum, that's an impossible ticket. You're not getting a ticket to that show if you ain't got it already. And it's probably a very expensive ticket, too. So very, very interesting. But Kyle Washington, man, let us know what you're most looking forward to in all these matchups. There's so many opportunities here. So much room for activities, you know, with inside this bracket. So it's March Madness. Love it. Love it. Love it. Let us know what you're looking forward to the most, and appreciate all the mailbag questions, guys, from Gail Perkins, Andrew Vasquez, and Kyle Washington. Let's go ahead and give our picks. We've talked about so much, we've probably spoiled a lot of it, but let's go ahead and break down and actually give our Sweet 16 picks, which we will be actually posting and publishing on the site as well. So in case you didn't miss the podcast, or you know a friend who couldn't catch the podcast, let them know that we are going to be posting our picks on paper so you can see them. That will be up before the game start, of course. So spread the word, MyFantasySportsTalk.com. Let's go ahead and start in that East region where the number 8 Wisconsin Badgers will be taking on the number 4 seed Florida Gators. I'm going to go ahead and stick with Wisconsin. Think they're right. Again, I like what they did. If they can beat Villanova, they definitely can beat Florida. And maybe my anti-SEC bias will bite me again, but I'm going to ride with Wisconsin in this one. And then Baylor and South Carolina, again, that SEC non-bias. If we end up with Florida and South Carolina matching up in the Elite Eight for a chance to go to the Final Four, I don't know what I'll do. My bracket will be pretty busted, but that's the region that got busted anyway. But I definitely got Baylor. So I got Wisconsin and Baylor in that East, and I'm going to roll with Baylor. I like Baylor. Baylor claimed the number one ranking in the year. They hung in there all year long. I think they will survive this region, and that's a regroup. That's a regroup for me, folks. I had Villanova, but with what's left in my regroup and time to think about it, I'm rolling with Baylor to survive the East region and make it to the Final Four. Dan, your turn.
I'm going to take Wisconsin beating Florida. I'm still not sold on Florida. I mean, I think East Tennessee State and a Virginia team that just could not buy a bucket doesn't impress me too much.
Was more Virginia than you know, Florida just playing outstanding basketball.
Exactly. Yep. And I'm kind of just going with a homer pick with South Carolina to beat Baylor. I love that Thornwell guy. I like watching him play, and I think he can wreak havoc again against the Bears. So I have South Carolina, Wisconsin. I have Wisconsin moving on to the Final Four. Why not? I mean, they have the players to do it. You know, Nigel Hayes, Ethan Happ, you know, some of the other guys that you've mentioned. So, yeah, I mean, they're still a pretty deep team. So it always seems everyone, you know, every few years Wisconsin makes a run. They were in the championship game, what, 2 years ago or something like that. So it's there's players on the team that were in that championship game. So it's something you can't look away from, that type of experience in this time of year. It's something I'm going to go with.
You're right. You're right. By the time we published that, my pick may have changed. Dan made a compelling case there. I don't know. I like them both. Yeah, Wisconsin definitely has that March flair. They have that style. I don't know what it is. So we'll see. Orlando, what about that East? Who you got surviving?
Yeah, I want to go Wisconsin or Florida. Nigel Hayes just continues to be one of the best players in a nation or in the country, and I think the Badgers stay hot. It's going to be an interesting matchup, but again, just some of that leadership on that team. So I like Wisconsin advancing, and I'm going to take Baylor over South Carolina. I know South Carolina plays a lot of good defense, but I don't know if they're going to be able to hold the Bears under 80 points. I like Molly and Masson a lot. I think they continue to shine, and I think it's going to be hard for South Carolina to get by, even though they did knock off the Duke. So advancing to the Final Four, I'm gonna this is tough to pick, but I'm gonna go ahead and take Baylor over Wisconsin. And I think it's tough to take them over Wisconsin because of some of the players like Hayes and Kinnick that Wisconsin has, but I just think the Bears are gonna be able to outscore Wisconsin and advance to the Final Four.
There you go. That is hard. That is a hard choice. I'll be honest with you. But I think that'd be a great Elite Eight game. Maybe not one that everyone saw coming. And I don't know if you saw this, guys, but just a quick stat. Maybe you did. If you did, you shout out the answer. But there was like a little over 18 million brackets submitted on ESPN. Did you guys catch the number of how many got the Sweet 16 right?
Yeah, it was a very small percentage.
Dan?
No, I didn't. I didn't catch it on ESPN. No.
A little over 18 million brackets submitted. 18 got the entire Sweet 16 right. So not a very high number. So I thought that was kind of interesting. But let's move on. Let's talk about the West. Out West, I got them Gonzaga Bulldogs beating West Virginia. And I've got Arizona, who I've been high on all year long. Like Alonzo Trier, he's a flashy player. But I think Arizona is solid. And I don't think many people are talking about the West. I'm the first person to disrespect the Pac-12. But I like Arizona and Oregon and UCLA a lot. I really do. Got Arizona and Gonzaga meeting up in the Elite Eight game, which I think would be a fabulous one. I can see going either way, but I'm going to stick to my guns and pick Gonzaga to finally make that Final Four and win that battle out West. But would not be surprised and would not be disappointed if Arizona were to win that. But I'm sticking with the Gonzaga, the number one seed. Dan, West, what you got?
Yeah, the Zags are going down. That's pretty simple there. West Virginia, the Bobby Huggins bat. He's gonna bear hug his way into the Elite Eight with that defense that you're gonna see. They're just gonna be smothering. The only thing that West Virginia has to worry about is size. They don't have somebody who can.
How are they gonna smother Karnowski?
Yeah, so I mean that's the biggest thing. As long as they can do that, I think they're gonna take home the W. And I have Arizona advancing past Xavier. And watch out for Arizona, man. If they can get to the Final Four, they will win the championship. It's in Arizona. It's in their home court. They are going to win the championship if they make it to the Final Four. I don't have them making it. I have them losing to West Virginia in the Elite Eight. But if they do, watch out, because that can be a dangerous team. And you know, home court advantage in that type of scenario it's going to be huge.
Yeah, that's what a lot of people are talking about too. With that that home court advantage, I think maybe Charles Barkley maybe predicted that. It wouldn't surprise me anyway. But
we saw an example of that anyway with South Carolina. That home court will play a big factor.
Well, I think Arizona is a good enough team to actually do it. I really do.
Yeah,
it's about five or six, maybe even seven teams out of the final 16 that I really think could win the championship. That's why just the South region alone, I think everyone could win the championship. I think Butler would be an outside shot, but I think everyone else I could totally understand if they won the championship. Wouldn't be surprised at all. But Orlando.
Yeah, I'm going to take West Virginia as well over Gonzaga. I mean, I think we saw them get a little bit exposed when they struggled a bit in the past round. And look, no one left in the tournament has more experience in close games than West Virginia. That was a stat I saw earlier. I mean, I know in nine losses, three of those games in overtime were no more than 9 points. I think West Virginia beats Gonzaga and advances. And I do like Arizona over Xavier as well. I just think Arizona gets off to a better start and they stay hot. And some of the scoring that both of these teams have been doing, I know they've been, some of them have been lower tier teams, but both of these teams can score as well. And I'm going to go ahead and take Arizona over West Virginia to advance to the Final Four.
Yep. Sticking to my guns, but I like both those teams a whole lot, and they may become my sentimental favorites, and just who I'm rooting for as soon as North Carolina gets knocked out, if they do get knocked out. But let's move on. We'll go up and over to the Midwest, where Kansas will take on Purdue in the Sweet 16 matchup. I'm going to roll with Kansas. This one's tough for me because I just think Kansas is playing what I saw out of the first weekend, that Kansas is playing the best ball, and they've been right there at the number one all year long. I really thought they probably should have got the number one overall seed in the tournament. But I'm going to roll with Kansas. It's my theme here of sticking with the number one seeds over Purdue. I think they'll find a way to contain the big guys of Swanigan, or at least neutralize them enough and score more points because, like Dan said, Josh Jackson. I think they'll have more firepower on the floor. I just think they'll work it out. But I'm really, really looking for outside the South. That's probably the matchup that I'm most intrigued by in the Sweet 16. But I do have Kansas over Purdue. Oregon, Michigan. I'm so interested in Dan's take, although I already know about the Kansas-Purdue game, because now that we reset everything, apparently the loss of Bobby Boucher, was not as big a problem as Oregon or fans or anybody else thought it might have been. We'll see. But now they draw Michigan. So I'm totally, before that, if it was Louisville in my original bracket, you probably would have saw Louisville there in that line. But now I have Oregon beating Michigan. But now we probably do run into a problem where Boucher does make a difference for Oregon. I'm going to stick with that. Number one team that I think playing right now, Kansas, the Kansas Jayhawks, and yet another number one seed to make the Final Four out of the Midwest. Dan?
Yeah, I mean, this is going to be tough for me. Kansas-Purdue, I do have Purdue picked in my bracket, but if we are resetting things, I do think Kansas will win the game. I'll be rooting hard for Purdue, that's no doubt, but I just think Kansas overall is the better team, and guard play matters a lot in the tournament, and when you have Frank Mason running the point, I mean, he's your quarterback of your team, and he sets it all up, and the way he's playing is kind of leading the Kansas charge. And then when you look at Oregon, Michigan, the reason Boucher.
I'll forget by the next time I say it.
The reason why you haven't seen his effectiveness is just the teams they've played. I mean, they don't really have – they didn't play big teams like Rhode Island. They're playing a 6'7 center. So the size, matching up against Boucher where he can be in the paint like that. I mean, they took a lot of further jump shots that you saw if you watched that game. So I think that's why maybe you didn't see that type of factor. I still have Oregon beating Michigan. Michigan's hot, but I just don't see them as a good team. They got some decent players, but just watching them a few times this year, I don't see it. Props to them for being as high as they are into the tournament, winning games. That Louisville win, impressive without a doubt. But I just think Oregon will end up beating them. And then the Elite Eight, if Kansas is there, I'm going to go with Kansas. But if Purdue's there, I'm going to go with Purdue too. I'm just going to say it just because I like Purdue. So whoever wins that Purdue-Kansas game will move on to the Final Four. I'll say that.
So you're saying Michigan's run is about to come to an end. They're pretty much at the end of the road. Great run. Kind of like what Arkansas did. They just kind of ran into a bigger beast in North Carolina and bowed out. So you think Michigan will do the same thing. And then you think finally the loss of Boucher will hurt Oregon.
Yeah, I mean, it's tough to say that. I mean, I can see Michigan winning. I'll say that just because they're a hot team. You know, I counted UConn out a few times in the tournament a few years ago when they were a 7 seed and won the championship behind Kemba Walker. So I counted them out before. I'm counting Michigan out a lot, but who knows? I can definitely see them going on a run. But I have them losing, yes.
That's what we do in March Madness, man. It's a lot of, well, I can see this and I can see that, but I really think this is not going to happen if that happened, you know. Orlando, talk about the Midwest. Who's going to survive?
I'm picking Purdue over Kansas. I know that may seem like a hard pick for some people, but looking at it, Frank Mason and Josh Johnson through the first few games have combined for 82 points of the Jayhawks, 190. And while that may be pretty impressive and superb, I just think looking at the Boilermakers, their offense is built around, their forward, Caleb Swanigan. And their depth is what I like. I think that's what makes them scary. So I know this is going to be an intriguing matchup. It's going to be very close, but I will gladly take Purdue over Kansas. And looking at Oregon and Michigan, Michigan right now just looks destined to win. So this game could go either way. Michigan's just on that one, but give me Tyler Dorsey and the Ducks over Michigan. I think the Ducks just continue to go. I think Dorsey continues to carry the team. They've got playmakers in the backcourt. And I like Oregon in this game. And the Elite Eight, this is going to be another tough matchup. But I'm going to take the Boilermakers over the Ducks advancing to the Final Four.
There you go. So Orlando's definitely high on Purdue. You mentioned that depth, and I'm right there with you because they bring the big guy with 7'1", 7'2", Isaac Haas. They bring him off the bench. Then Spike Albrick transfer from Michigan. So you're right. They do have a lot of players off the bench. They can come in and control the game, and they don't really lose a step. But what I like is when they play Isaac Haas and Swanigan on the floor at the same time because that's unstoppable. That is crazy. That's almost like the New Orleans Pelicans. But – A lot of stuff to look forward there. I don't know, man. I don't know. I think Oregon will beat Michigan, but I think Kansas, Purdue could go either way. So interesting stuff. Now we get down to it, the South region, the picks in the South. Guys, I think I've spoiled it before. I got North Carolina winning this whole shindig when it's all said and done. So I'm going to have them beating Orlando's Butler Bulldogs. And again, my disrespect of the SEC may bite me. I don't know. We'll see. But I'm going to stick with UCLA. Like I said, if UCLA was in the West in Arizona spot, then I would have had North Carolina and UCLA in the championship game. Very disappointed the committee set it up like this, but I'm going to have UCLA beating Kentucky. And then, like I just said, I think North Carolina is the best team. When I can name so many players on their team, like Joel Berry, Kennedy Meeks, Justin Jackson Johnson. Well, I said I was bragging too early, but anyway, all those guys played last year. So really like North Carolina. I think overall they are the best team in the tournament. So I got North Carolina advancing, and yet that theme of the number one seeds advancing continues. Got three of the number one seeds in the final four. What do Dan have?
Yeah, I have North Carolina over Butler, 20 points, easy. I don't think it'll be a contest. Turn it off at halftime. Go make some nachos and don't come back to the game. When you're looking at UCLA, Kentucky, I'm going to give you five words on the outcome of that game and why I'm going to pick this team. LeVar Ball told me so, UCLA.
How can you go against that?
And when you look at that North Carolina UCLA matchup, five more words. LeVar Ball told me so. UCLA advances. There we go. Well, that's all you're getting.
I got nothing. Well, I don't need any more. I don't need any more. I mean, it's probably been memed already and confirmed. If it's a meme, it's confirmed. There you go. LeVar Ball. Did you have a conversation with LeVar Ball, Orlando? What did he tell you?
He told me not to listen to Dan when it comes to Butler. That's what he told me. Okay, now, but all jokes aside, looking at the picks, I got to stick with my guns. And this is a scary matchup. And I mean, you guys are right. I mean, Butler's victories came as no surprise, you know, beating a 12 seed and a 13 seed in last weekend's rounds. So, I mean, it wouldn't be a shock if North Carolina advances. But I'm going to go ahead and stick with my guns because, you know what, if Arkansas was able to give North Carolina a run for the money game, a bit of a scare. And I know that happens from time to time. And, you know, a lot of times in games, it's who could prevent the less to North. But let me tell you one thing. If North Carolina goes into the game and they fall 10, 11, 14 points down to the game, I don't expect them to just build this big lead. And I mean, it could happen. But if they fall into a hole like that against Butler, give me Butler comfortably. I'm not going to say they go in there and blow out North Carolina, but I'm going to go ahead and stick with my guns. I do think it will be a close game, but give me Butler. And when it comes to Kentucky and UCLA, again, it's a shame that this matchup has to be in the Sweet 16. But I'm going to go ahead and stick with UCLA. Besides Alonzo Ball balling out, I think a lot of it
– LeVar Ball, too.
Yeah, LeVar Ball, too. Bryce Alford, I think, could play a huge part in this game. Looking at the Elite Eight, this is going to be tough. But unfortunately, I'm going to have to say, when it comes down to Butler and UCLA, I'm going to say that UCLA advances.
LeVar Ball told you. So LeVar Ball is hypnotizing y'all. Is that what it is?
You know, I listened to the intelligence of LeVar Ball speak out, and, you know, you just have to flock to it, don't you? No?
I guess. That appears to be right. I'm a little disappointed in Orlando, though. You're letting LeVar Ball talk you out of your Butler pick.
All right, you know, I'll go. You know, that's tough for me to, you know, that's a little tough, but I do like what UCLA is doing. It's a bit tough, but I mean, I do got Butler over North Carolina a lot. You know, y'all two don't even have that happening. So the fact that I have them going into the Elite Eight says a lot.
Hey, I like it. Right on. They're playing good. They're playing good. All right, well, we'll talk more Final Four and give our predictions next week, recap all this March Madness mania next week, I promise you. But right now, we're going to talk LeVar Ball and NBA. You're listening to and watching My Fantasy Podcast from MyFantasySportsTalk.com. Brandon Reed, Dan Schott, Orlando Torres. We are all here. So let's just kick off the NBA talk real quick today. I just want to give a quick look at the standings, a little look around the league. Cleveland Cavaliers are still up in the West, guys. They're up by two games on those Boston Celtics, and the Wizards have slipped back a little bit to that third spot at 4.5 games. Toronto holding down that four spot, Atlanta 5, Indiana 6, Milwaukee 7, and Detroit Pistons are battling the Heat for a playoff spot. Chicago Bulls went on such a losing streak, they're completely out of this thing. Orlando, looking at the Eastern Conference, I don't know, just what do you think about the standings right now? Any surprises, anything that stands out to you? What's going on in the East right now as far as who's hot, who's not?
Boston is starting to raise eyebrows, just a game behind Cleveland, and Washington is so far behind. I mean, other than that, maybe Toronto taking a bit of a dip, but I know they went ahead and lost Kyle Lowry. So other than that, everything's about right. I mean, I was thinking about it. Imagine if Dwayne Wade didn't – I know he was having some problems there in Miami, but imagine if he didn't jump ship to Chicago. Maybe, you know, Miami would have been a little bit more better in the standings. I mean, but other than that, regardless what happens, again, I just think it's the Cleveland show as long as LeBron's there. When it comes down to Boston and Washington, I'm thinking they're missing a couple few pieces to compete with the Cavs. But it's still going to be interesting, those top four seeds.
Well, I did notice that Kevin Love is actually dressing out now. Not really any threat of playing, I don't think, but he's not in street clothes anymore. So you got to think he's closer to returning.
Or he just doesn't want to wear a suit.
Maybe you can't. Everybody can't look as good as Chandler Parsons in a suit. Okay, that's just the bottom line. Okay, thought you knew. All right, go ahead, Dan. What's up in the East? Boston Celtics looking pretty good, but
yeah, I mean it's not. There's no team. I mean, if you look at, you know, their last 10, they're all kind of 5-5, 6-4. Some are even less. You know, the Bucks are the best at 8-2. So you look at the teams that are hot. They're kind of all the middle of the road right now. So nothing too impressive. You still kind of have to stick with the Cavs until somebody proves that they can beat them. But I wouldn't be surprised if you see, you know, if they meet up with Boston in the Eastern Conference Finals, see how they would do.
I don't know if you knew about it, Brandon, or it was kind of a joke. I'm not too sure. But Kevin Love is actually back with the Cavs. He played Sunday against the Lakers, and he had 21
points. Oh, did he?
Yeah, he had 21 points in 25 minutes. So he's looking pretty good. And that's because the Lakers actually gave the Cavs a run for the money. The final score is 125-120. So, I mean, imagine if Kevin Love wasn't there. I'm not saying that the Cavs wouldn't be able to pull it off. But Kevin Love did come back in time. Of course, LeBron went off too, 34 points. And so did Kyrie Irving. So Kevin Love is ready back in the lineup. He's still getting rest. I think they're going to be more cautious with him, especially in back-to-back games and getting closer to the playoffs. But, yeah, Kevin Love is ready back.
So did they rest him with the other guys? It was the big stir. You
know? Saturday, yes, they pulled a Spurs and Warriors, and they rested everybody.
Okay, but he played Sunday.
He played Sunday, yes. Which, okay, to me, didn't make sense. I think they could have all rested Sunday against the Lakers and played that primetime game on Saturday.
Okay, so he is actually playing meaningful minutes. So from what you saw, what did you say? He looked pretty good, decent?
Yeah, right? 21 points in 25 minutes. I think that's pretty good.
Yeah, not bad. So, all right, let's just say he's back fully healthy for the playoffs, which we all kind of thought that it would be, you know, at least back by the playoffs. And he's got plenty of time now. We're still about 3 weeks out before the playoffs actually start. So, Orlando, do you think there's any competition if Kevin Love is back for the Cavs and let's just say 85%, is there any competition in the East to knock off the Cavs?
Celtics. I think they were given a chance. I'm not going to say that nobody completely touches the Cavs. I know Boston could give them a run. It comes down to it. Hell, even the Wizards.
But a chance to beat them. I mean, a chance to go to the finals. No, seriously.
No. I'm going to stick with the Cavs.
Dan may feel differently. Dan, do you really think the Boston Celtics could beat the Cavs with Kevin Love?
Yeah. I mean, I definitely think so. It's definitely not out of the realm of possibility. I think it'll be a long series.
Cleveland with the signing of Deron Williams really shored up their depth a lot to me. So that kind of flips it to me.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not going to put the stock in whether the Cavs advance to the finals on Deron Williams. I think it would be more, you know, LeBron doing what LeBron does, taking over the game and the ways that he does. But, you know, it's just the way Isaiah Thomas has played this year. He kind of has become this game changer, I guess you would say, where he can just take over a game. And I didn't know that was in him before. So he's kind of elevated himself to that superstar level. And to win in the playoffs, you know, if you have that superstar, you have a chance. So, you know, if some may view him as you know, one of those type of superstar players, but we'll see this postseason, because the way Boston plays, I definitely think they can give him a chance. And even when Kevin Love is healthy, Cleveland just looks out of sync. They have all year to me, and it hasn't been I haven't seen any dominating performance where it's like, okay, yeah, Cavs are NBA final. They're going to be in the NBA finals. It's all, yeah, LeBron is on the team, so he's going to do it. Well, maybe he won't. You never know.
They've looked out of sync before, though, and I'm not putting my stock in anyone in the playoffs who shot. Yeah, I can block. I mean, if I can block your shot, I ain't putting too much stock in you.
I'm not saying the Celtics will win, but I definitely think they have a chance to win.
Okay. Fair enough. I really think it's a three-team race. I don't think anyone I don't think anyone is thinking outside of the Celtics or the Wizards have any chance at beating the Cleveland Cavaliers. I don't know. Maybe there's some Toronto folks hanging on to hope, but Orlando just told me Kevin Love is back and actually playing meaningful minutes, and I think that's going to be it. And I am not overlooking that signing of Deron Williams, because that was really only my problem depth-wise for the Cavs, is they did a pretty damn good job, because Deron Williams could be starting for a lot of teams. So he was starting for the Mavs. But let's move on and talk about the West real quick. Like we talked about in the open, the San Antonio Spurs lost that lead. They're 2.5 back of the Warriors right now. So KD is still in street clothes, right, Orlando? We ain't seen him back yet.
No, not yet. He's still in street clothes, and I think the Warriors are going to kind of play like that, getting closer to playoff time. I don't think there's any rush for them to rush him back, and rightfully so. I mean, they're number one seed. They have a 2.5 game lead over the Spurs and pretty much comfortably over Houston and Utah at the moment. So there's no need to rush Durant back, especially with rotation they have going on. They're still hurting, if you ask me, on their depth. Regardless of that, I mean, they still got three superstars on the team, and I don't think we see Kevin Durant closer to the end of April.
Well, you don't like JaVale McGee? Are you telling me you don't like JaVale McGee? Man, not everybody liked JaVale. But yeah, we'll see. I don't know. Until KD gets back and gets right, I don't think they're going to be right. But what I'm really looking and interested in is that logjam right in the middle there. I mean, Memphis is not even inconceivably out of catching Utah. Utah is currently in the 4 spot. Clippers are in 5. Oklahoma City is at the 6, and Grizzlies are at the 7. Nobody is really in danger of falling to that 8. Denver Nuggets, they're battling for that, but no one is in danger really of falling to 8 out of the playoffs. But everybody else outside the Rockets is kind of up for grab there. Dan, what is the most interesting scenario going on in the West right now?
Yeah, I mean, I think that logjam is impressive. If I'm you, Brandon, and a Grizzlies fan, I'm hoping to God they lose some games, lock up that 7 seed, take out the Spurs in the first.
Or win and get to 5.
Yeah, but then you're still, who are you going to play, the Jazz or Clippers? I would honestly, if I was the Grizzlies, I would take the Spurs over the Jazz or Clippers. I just don't think it's a matchup-wise, it's good for the Grizzlies. I mean, you look at those two type of teams who I think are a little bit more athletic and non-geriatric to take in a series. So, you know, that's me. And it sounds crazy. Even when I say it, it sounds a little weird, but I kind of would do that. I mean, I don't want to see those teams in the Jazz scare me. Is it first round matchups, not necessarily legitimate, you know, contenders in the West. But yeah, I mean, that logjam, it's going to be interesting how it plays out towards the rest of the year. And I'm on the Rockets bandwagon. I said it last week, you know, or a couple weeks ago. I do remember that, at least. But I think the Rockets are Western Conference contenders, and I put them at the three-team race in the West. I am putting the Spurs there because you never know. But I think it's going to come down to either the Warriors, Spurs, or Rockets who come out of that West, and I wouldn't be surprised if it is the Rockets, especially if KD doesn't come back 100% right away.
if he doesn't. I think he will, because I mean, this injury we're talking about is not an injury that required any kind of surgery or anything like that. Right. So I think it's just a matter of resting and a scare.
Yeah, I mean, Steph Curry struggled in the finals and towards the end of the playoffs when he twisted or hurt something or sprained something. So that didn't require surgery, and he saw kind of how he was off. But I think they rushed him back. I don't think the Warriors have to rush Kevin Durant
back. And that was bad timing, too. We're talking about, you know, late in the playoffs, mid-playoff series, and you ain't got time for it. You know, it's either – this is it, you know. But you could be right about the Grizzlies as far as looking back at the Grizzlies, because – if you were to take on that 5-4 matchup, if you win the first round matchup, then you're looking at a second round matchup with Golden State. So maybe, I don't know, Dan would probably disagree with this, but would you rather, I mean, if you're looking at a second round matchup, if you're the Grizzlies and you stick to the number 7 seed right now and take out the San Antonio Spurs in the first round, then you are looking at that second round matchup most likely with the Houston Rockets. So I guess what I'm saying is, would you rather play Houston or Golden State in the second round?
If I'm Grizzlies, I would rather play Houston. I mean, right. Golden State has this aura, you know, and they – I don't think they match up well with the Grizzlies either. Not that Houston does, but, you know, they can have off more. I think Houston is more has a chance to have more off nights where they don't put up 125 points, where, you know, the Warriors, I think, can go off at any given time.
Right. So last little topic about the standings. I want to get Orlando's take real quick. So how do you feel about the Spurs' chances right now? How's the team, you know, just kind of checking in on San Antonio, because the inquiring minds would like to know. What's the feel of the team right now? How does everyone feel about, I don't know, just chances, seeding, you know, chances to win it all?
A little bit worrisome. I'll talk around town, yeah, especially seeing that on a 3-game losing streak. Was a bit eyebrow raising. I think a lot of the talk around here, a lot of people do want to see them grab that number one seed and kind of lock up the home court advantage. But this is just shocking. I mean, and you know, if you look at it transitioning, it's Kawhi's team now. But I know there was a lot of questions coming into the season how they would do too. You know, we'll probably be able to do it again. You know, with Kawhi, and I think that, you know, he answered that question. I know we just got LaMarcus Aldridge back. He did have that heart scare. It wasn't as major, you know, as it was made out to seem at first. But I know they're
– you didn't know, though. Yeah, because like Dan mentioned, you saw what happened to Chris Bosh. You didn't really know. Just you were hoping for the best, and it turned out all right.
Exactly. So, I mean, they're taking it easy with Tim, too. I know the Trailblazers ruined his return to the court I forgot his name, but he went off superstar in the Trailblazers. I just had a brain fart. But that's what started the loss. And then again,
McCollum.
No, it wasn't CJ McCollum. Lillard, exactly. Lillard had 36 points. Yeah. And I recently with the Grizzlies too, we were able to bounce back on track against the Kings. So I do. I think if push comes to shove, I think the Spurs are okay with the 2 seed and just letting Golden State flow with the 1 seed. But again, Golden State has been struggling as well. So it's going to be interesting. I think it's going to finish like that. Golden State, San Antonio, and Houston. You could flip-flop 1 and 2 between Golden State and the Spurs. But I'm going to agree with Dan. I said it before, too. Houston's not too far from here. I know a couple of Houston fans, and Houston is a scary team. James Harden, Eric Gordon, that's a scary team. I think that's a dark horse team to make the Western Conference Finals and possibly even the Finals. The Spurs have struggled. We've seen it. If Kevin Durant's not right and they have to play the Warriors, I mean, Harden will get the – and Gordon will give the Golden State a run for their money. So it is a 3-way race in the West. Looking at the other teams, I agree with you. I mean, you say the Grizzlies are going to take out the Spurs. Well, you know, I'll take those chances than rather have to face.
So will we.
So I'd rather take those chances than rather have to face, let's say, Clippers fall to the 7th seed, because a healthy Clippers team has given us trouble before. Think about a couple of years back in the round one when they won the full 7 games. Even Oklahoma, minus the Kevin Durant, they still get the Spurs trouble just the way they match up with the speed and everything. They still get the Spurs trouble to this day. So looking at those teams, I wouldn't mind facing a Grizzlies and taking the chances at that in advancing. So I am with you on there, even though I do think the Spurs will come out on top. But, you know, being that the Grizzlies are 2-0 so far into the season, I mean, yeah, that is a bit worrisome. And I think even though the Grizzlies came out in Angshat too, like, hey, you know, you got to give us respect too sometimes, because I did see that. And, you know, give them respect what it's due, because looking at the West, it's stacked. I mean, they are 13 games behind San Antonio, 16 behind Golden State, and not too far behind Houston. But, I mean, looking at those it's going to be quite a race, just like you said, because any of those teams could leapfrog another team.
Well, and I do agree with you. It's from a Grizzly standpoint, yes, I'm happy that we're 2-0 versus the Spurs. I'm not really scared of that matchup. It may be the more ideal matchup of the first round of the playoffs that you're possibly looking at. But if I am a Spurs fan, then I probably wouldn't. Yeah, I'd rather face the Grizzlies than the Los Angeles Clippers. That's me. I think the Clippers are a team. They kind of struggle from time to time, but when they're fully healthy and clicking, they're a dangerous team that could steal a series. But speaking of stealing a series, I want to update you guys on the MyFantasySportsTalk.com NBA Fantasy League real quick, because we are in the semifinals. So it is myself and Christian Mina playing in a basketball contest, and Christian is giving it to me. Dan, if you survive this matchup, you may not be playing me. Christian Mina is really giving me fits since this matchup started. It's been a very close contest. Right now I'm winning 946 to 940 as we speak, and it's going on. Dan is taking on Dylan Davis Tirado in a matchup of the 2 and 3 seed. And Dan, you're currently up 1,010 to 990, so by 20 points. And that's been a pretty good battle this whole time as well. And we still have until Sunday before the matchups end.
Yeah. I mean, it's looking like a showdown between me and Mina. So, you know, I'm looking forward to it. Christian, shout out to you. Look forward to the championship series. But it is a nice shout out to DDT, Dylan Davis Tirado, great writer of ours. I forgot to do my lineup twice, Dylan. Come on.
You better not. DDT will score 180 on a given day like that.
Yep, I put a 5 spot up because I failed to do my lineup once, so and then I forgot again. So, you know, but now I'm on top of my game. I've been doing my lineup switches, so I'm very, very confident I'm going to make it to the ship. So it's whoever needs to battle it out between New Breed and Mina, because they're going to be taking on the Dan right now. Well, next week, I guess.
Well, I ain't going to lie. I'm not feeling great about it. I am not feeling 100% confident about it. I'll tell you that right now. It's scary, but I'm going to use all of my acquisitions. Okay, Christian, I'm going to tell you that. I'm going to use every damn one of my acquisitions. I'm not going to leave any spot unturned, any rock unturned, any position left unfilled until I beat you. You can't take the number one seed like that. This ain't no kind of Wisconsin-Villanova thing going on here right now. I learned something from the NCAA this week, but anyway, let's answer some mailbag questions. The first one comes from Larry Dubs Walker. It's not quite Doo-Wop like we had last week, but Dubs is a little bit cooler, a little bit hipper, to be honest with you. Well, at least in 2017, that's what I would think the kids would rather be called, Dubs than Doo-Wop. But Larry Dubs Walker, should NBA teams be required to play their players if healthy? And you can edit this out if you want, but La Breep is a Breep, says Larry Dubs Walker. You can fill in the bleeps with whatever word you want. He's not high on LeBron James is what he's saying. But should the NBA require teams, take action, and require teams to play their players if healthy? Orlando, how do you feel about this issue?
I'm going to disagree with them. I mean, he sounds like he is taking a bit of jabs at LeBron. And I guess from that standpoint, I agree that LeBron and, you know, Kyrie and Kevin Love could have played that Saturday primetime game because they're all healthy. You know, it makes more sense that they play that game on ABC as scheduled and take Sunday off, because they don't have a game Monday and Tuesday. They don't play again until Wednesday tomorrow. But, you know, by the time it hears, the game would have been started. So it makes more sense that they would have played that Saturday game compared to them take the day off and then play Sunday, you know, because then they get 3 days off after that. But as far as when it comes to resting, yes, especially getting closer to playoffs, I'm resting my guys, regardless of what anybody says. I know it's a money league. I know they're going to, you know, a lot of stations, Disney, ABC, ESPN, a lot of those, you know, the big networks are going to get mad that they're resting these guys. But, you know, you look at some of these back-to-backs, and, you know, I think they have to. Golden State, for example, too, they had that crazy road trip. I don't remember the games exactly, but they had that 8-game crazy road trip where they had like 3 back-to-backs. And I know some people threw a fit too because they rested their guys against the Spurs last week. But it made sense, and especially when they got blown out, right? Or they got beat pretty bad by Minnesota that Friday before. I mean, so if I'm Kerr, Steve Kerr, I'm resting my guys too. So when it comes down to rest, I don't agree with that. And I think the league going forward next year will be a little bit better when it comes to scheduling and how they schedule some of these back-to-back games. These back-to-back games, especially when they're primetime games. I think you are going to see a little bit more of a bit of a cushion when it comes to primetime games. And Saturday's not the only primetime games they play. You think about it. They got the Tuesday night fan games. They, you know, TNT always has those Thursday night games.
Right, even Monday night now.
And even Monday night now. So, because I know Saturday they're trying to make it, you know, I saw they're trying to compare.
That's a new thing. That's kind of a TV contract dispute right now. That's why they're unhappy, because you got this new Saturday primetime thing, and now it's not working out.
Well, they're trying to compare it to like their version of Monday Night Football, but I mean, that's not going to happen. You know, the NBA's, you know, it's always fully loaded.
What a lot of people forgot about this Saturday night is you ain't beating March Madness. I don't care if the Globetrotters are playing the 95 Bulls. You ain't beating March Madness.
Exactly. So I know there, yeah, and again, it comes down to a lot of those ratings. So, but looking at that, I think next year the NBA will schedule some of these teams better, especially on primetime games. And I do not have a problem with teams resting their players.
Yeah, because Pop started it all. You know why? Because he got a bunch of old guys, right, Dan?
He started it all, and everybody caught on.
Yeah.
Well, it's because they ran Matlack reruns at the game time. They just couldn't miss it. It just couldn't happen. So, you know, that's something to do with it, I think.
Matlack and Murder, She Wrote. Anyway.
Oh, I will continuously give my thanks to Pop, because if it wasn't for him resting Tim Duncan, we wouldn't be able to play until he was 40. So I will say that.
I'm not going to say it wasn't smart, that's for sure. And I'm not going to say it wasn't smart at all. And they have done what they've had to do, and I don't think it's the NBA's business. So, but anyway, Dan, how do you feel about it?
Yeah, I'm kind of indifferent to it. I understand both sides. It's definitely today's NBA isn't, you know, you the 80s NBA where you know, stars played every game. So I understand the need for it. I wouldn't mind something, you know, to policy it a little bit, you know, do have the NBA do like an injury report type of thing like the NFL does, where you have to, you know, put guys on an injury report if they're going to miss a game, or do something of that. So at least it's, you know,
but you could lie, though, right? That's kind of the thing I would tell the NBA is teams could lie to you. LeBron could sit out due to a bone bruise. Who the hell knows what that means? It's a bone bruise.
He's sitting out. So maybe the thing is, if he has that bone bruise, when did he get it? Because on the injury reports, we have to document that type of stuff.
The NBA would go to that quite extent.
Right, that's what I'm saying. So they would need to do something like that if they were to policy it. I don't think they can just say no, you're not allowed to rest players. Well, that's obviously not going to work. Having policies in place might be able to get you there, but ultimately I don't see it happening. You know, screw the NBA about it. It's just not putting money in their pockets, but I don't really care about that, to be honest with you. You know, if the NBA misses a couple million, they're making plenty. Look at the salary cap and the contracts they give out. So if players don't want to, you know, if they want to rest, you know, more power to them, I guess. You know, I don't really care too much. I'm not at those games, but if I'm at those games, that's where I kind of want to see it, you know.
Well, I agree with you there. That's why I would be a little bit indifferent too. But in this day and age, I'd be very careful about who I buy tickets to go see and what time of the year it is, because it could happen. And I know people it's happened to, and I feel bad for them. The Cleveland Cavaliers game was won this year. I know someone who bought tickets for him and his son, you know, for a Grizzlies game to go see the Cavaliers. And that's when they didn't play the big three at all. And that was very disappointing. But I learned vicariously through that. I may not buy tickets to go see those teams anymore. And one thing about it is, if that's what we're really going to, and if you're only buying tickets, and I'm speaking for anybody all across the world, you know, if you're only buying tickets to go see the visiting team play, then shame on you. You should be buying more regular tickets to go see your home market play if you live in a home market, you know. But I mean, Orlando could attest to that. Spurs fans ain't necessarily eating up tickets to go see LeBron and them play. They're the product, you know. I know it's going to be a more expensive ticket. I understand that. Warriors, Thunder, you know, Cavs, there's going to be a little bit more expensive ticket, but they're selling out anyway because the Spurs are the product.
Well, that was what you were saying, too. For example, I had a friend in a real story who there was this guy selling a pair of tickets to the Spurs and Warriors game because, you know, it was a highly anticipated game. And he was selling the pair for $1,200. Once it was announced that Eric Brady was basically going to be resting, he was able to grab that pair off the guy for $200 for the two seats, and even has pictures of, you know, Kawhi, Steph from like the fourth row. Great seats. So speaking of what you said, ticket prices will drop, and you know, that might mean things for, you know, going into next season. People probably won't want to pay the premium for a game like that if there's going to be the risk of not seeing their star players.
Well, and that's exactly right, because that's what happened in this situation of a guy I know. I mean, he bought the tickets earlier for the Cavs when no one knew what was going to go on. You know, probably paid $7,500 for the each ticket. And people sitting around him when he got to the game probably only paid $10 for their ticket, you know, because it was post-announcement of the Big Three not playing. So that does suck. And I do understand that. And if you personally get bit by that, I understand it. But I'll tell you this. I don't want the NBA interfering. They cannot interfere, mediate, or control this situation in any way, because each one of these teams is their own businesses, and they decide who works when. Every business in the world makes out a schedule, and they decide who works when, okay? I know this is a little bit different, but just as I was saying, anyone could say, if you want to get around this, well, he has a bone bruise. LeBron James has played more games in the NBA than anyone in the last decade, because he's made 7 straight NBA finals. I want you to hear that right, okay? So he's played a lot of games, and I hear the old school guys like Karl Malone saying what they're saying, but I don't think Karl Malone led as busy of a lifestyle as LeBron James. LeBron James makes more off the court than he does on the court. Way, way, way more money off the court. He has other responsibilities too. So I don't want the NBA interfering in this. They can't. They cannot legislate this at all. Okay, it's just something you're going to have to deal with and buy tickets for games more cautiously as a fan. You don't hear this in the NFL about fans who buy tickets to week 17 games. I mean, if it happens, it happens, but it's the same thing, and that's been going on for many years, and everyone understands. If you're a fan of a home team in the NFL and you're already projected to make the playoffs, 1, 2, 3 seed comfortably in the playoffs, you probably don't want your star quarterback or running back playing in week 17 in a meaningless game. You know, you understand it's all about the championships, and that's what drives it. So I don't want the NBA meddling, and I'm sorry that some networks may lose some ratings and a little bit of money. I'm so sorry for you. You have to deal with the other billions of dollars that you're making. Let's talk about LeVar Ball. Thanks for the question, though, Larry Dubs Walker. That was a great one. The next question about LeVar Ball comes from LeVar Ball. Man, this dude, man, do you ever take a break? Now he's writing our show. I mean, he's everywhere. LeVar, dude, damn. Okay, we know. We heard of you. We know who you are. Tell me your any inner feelings about LeVar Ball, says LeVar Ball. Dan, go ahead. Talk about LeVar Ball before LeVar Ball starts tweeting about us.
Yeah, no, I mean, we all knew about Lonzo, and then we, you know, we knew about his brother putting up 92 in a high school game. And then all of a sudden, to me, kind of his dad came out of the woodwork and just started talking. And I get a kick out of it, man. I love it. I think it's funny. I would hate to be his kids. There's no way I would want that dude to be my dad. He's got to push them and grill. I mean, I wouldn't be able to live with it. But as like a fictional character out there in the world, I love LeVar Ball because I just think he's funny, man. Some of the stuff he comes up with, I'm like, do you really believe that, LeVar? Come on now, because there's no way. I sent you guys a picture the other day of a meme of where it was LeVar Ball said me and my 4 kids are there, me something about dunking from half court, and then him and his kids are the only ones that can do it. I just laughed. I thought it was great, but I actually think part of the reason it is so funny is because he actually does believe it. He is that crazy, and man, I can't wait to see Lonzo in the NBA and LeVar doing what he does, because I think it's going to be great. I think the NBA franchise that goes to him is going to hate it, and that would look like a team like the Lakers. You know, if they get that number 2 pick, if they don't get that number 1 pick, man, Lonzo's going to make those Showtime Lakers something with LeVar in the background. It's going to be great.
Orlando, is LeVar Ball trying to run for president in the next term?
In this crazy world we live in, I don't know. You got people, Oprah and Rosie O'Donnell saying they could run for president if Trump could do it. But, you know, that's another topic for another day. We don't do that here on this show. So, LeVar Ball, I mean, whatever he's doing, it's working. He's getting people to talk. I mean, I try my best to ignore him, but he's comical. He's a character. And, you know, LeVar Ball, he reminds me, you know, of this deadbeat dad. I'm not saying he is. I don't know the guy personally. But he's like, this, you know, this guy who just came out of nowhere, like this deadbeat dad. And unfortunately, with the situation going on, their moms, I know LeVar, but I know the mom's in the hospital for something going on. I'm not too close on what's going on in that story. But it seems like, okay, well, someone can't watch kids. Let's call grandma. And all of a sudden, it's like his kids are doing good. It's like, no, I'll come back in the picture. These are my kids. It's kind of like he's making a name or money off the kids for himself. So to put in an analogy like that, that's what LeVar Ball reminds me of. I mean, but again, I mean, he's getting people to talk. I mean, there's even you see Charles Barkley, the Chuckster, coming out and attacking him. You see Kenny on the TNT show coming out and attacking him. So again, what he's doing, he's talking out of his you know what, but it's getting people to talk. So I mean, I gotta give him that.
Well, I'll say the world gets tired of a delusional loudmouth really quickly, or at least a lot of us do. But anyway, I'll warn LeVar Ball, okay? I'll tell LeVar Ball of two people's names. There's more. There's a list of more. But I remember Shea Cotton from way back in the day. There's also another guy more recently named Corleone Young. Superstars coming out of high school, or projected superstars, supposed to be the next big thing. Not everybody can be a LeBron James, okay? I'll tell you this right now, LeVar Ball, none of your sons are ever going to be a LeBron James. It would be a success if any of your sons played 4 years in the NBA. It's a tough league. It ain't just happening for you, okay? He went out and did what he... There's stories about you can go read. I mean, he intentionally set out to marry a tall, athletic white woman, intentionally trying to have great athletic sons that could be really great athletes. So if you're setting goals like that, I would just caution you of many, many other tales like that in the NBA. Because as of right now, the Ball family hasn't accomplished anything. Anything in the game of basketball other than a lot of points in a high school game. But tired of talking about it. This is really a hot topic, and I wish it wouldn't be, because you still have a whole lot to prove in the game of basketball, and being a loudmouth doesn't really prove anything. Let's talk some NFL next. You're listening to and watching My Fantasy Podcast from MyFantasySportsTalk.com. So, man, so much March Madness, so much NBA talk. We're running long again. So much to pack into a two-hour show. So we're probably just going to run over. But I wanted to get some NFL news and notes in there. Brandon Reed here. Dan Schalk is here. Orlando Torres is here. I want to get y'all's thoughts on the latest news and notes out of the NFL. Of course, Eddie Lacy signed with the Seahawks. Orlando wrote about it. And we have some other – no, well, just today, Manti Te'o signed with the Saints. Geno went to the Giants, moved addresses in New York. Is that a actual – I guess that's – is that even a area code change for Geno, Dan?
No, I think it's just an east-west locker room change.
Here you go. So in case you didn't know, Geno to the Giants. But just those things. And also, what's the latest news on Tony Romo? Let me start with Dan. What is the latest on Tony Romo?
You know, I don't really know. My best educated guess would be that Jerry is holding out hope for a trade. He's ultimately going to release him, but he has time. He has until June 1st. There's always that talk that he doesn't want Romo to go to the Houston Texans, and I believe that. I don't think he would. That's maybe why he wants to possibly try to find a trade partner for him. But ultimately,
I see at this point, Dan, is that what you want?
No, at this point, just let him go. I mean, if you're going to anyways, you're not really going to get any. There's no value when everybody knows you're going to release him if you don't trade him.
Do you want him playing for the Houston Texans? Is that the best scenario?
Yeah, I do actually. I think that's his best chance to win, and I would love to see him in the Super Bowl. And I think the Texans give him that best chance with the defense and the weapons on offense. So I definitely would love to see him there.
So we're just kind of at a standstill with Tony Romo. Is that right, Orlando?
Yeah, and if you could see, who's that? My Tony Romo cup, my collectible cup. So yeah, speaking of Romo, there was actually a story that came out today, and this is far out of reach, but it's not out of reach of the realm of the NFL, the possibilities that we've seen. But Carolina supposedly has contacted about a trade for Romo. Now, that's probably not going to happen, but it was still interesting to see something like that. Supposedly, what the decline that the Panthers took last year, you know, there was a lot of talk that they blamed a lot of it on Cam Newton, and that they reached out to the Cowboys organization because they wouldn't mind a veteran guy like Romo to kind of bring that leadership to go into the,
start.
That's why it won't happen. That's why it won't happen, because I don't think there's a shot that Romo
because starts. he would beat Cam out, and all those Cam fans.
Exactly, and that was actually published today. I saw that today on FS1. So that was a bit eyebrow raising. So again, I doubt that happens. I think Houston is more of a possibility, and rather than Denver, because again, if I'm Houston and I'm speaking of Romo, I'm showing him highlights and blame. Look, there's this guy Joey Bosa that plays out there in the AFC West, and there's Khalil Mack. And if you want to stay one piece, you know, come to Houston where you'd be a bit more better compared to going to the AFC West. So just like that, I'm going to agree that Houston gives Romo the best shot for his career.
Well, yeah, these are some crazy scenarios y'all throwing out here at me. Crazy, crazy, crazy. I agree with Dan, though. I think Houston may be the best landing spot for Tony Romo, because he probably would start for sure, I would say. No one's beating him out at this point for the job. Plus, you have that number one defense. So I'd like to see that. But the Carolina scenario, y'all crazy. Cam won the MVP last year. They're paying the dude a ton of money. But anyway, Eddie Lacy to the Seahawks.
They're paying him a lot of money, but he wouldn't dive on the ball on the biggest game of his life. Let's not forget about that.
Oh, man, I don't care. There's a lot of quarterbacks making a lot of money that hadn't had close to the success that Cam Newton has for the Carolina Panthers. So that ain't changing. That's nutty nuts. But Orlando, you wrote about Eddie Lacy. So talk about Eddie Lacy.
Yeah. So again, I wrote about that, but there were some things I didn't know about when I wrote about it. Like the $3 million guaranteed and the other $2.5 million. I know it could go up to $5.5 million. So he's getting $3 million guaranteed. And the other rate comes as a bonus if he keeps up with this weight. So that was a bit interesting. So he's, you know, he's getting a bit of that bonus, you know, if, you know, he keeps his weight in tip-top shape. And I know there's certain strict stuff that he can't do or have on his contract. And again, I know last time we talked about this, Dan kind of talked about it, say that it won't work. But looking back at it, in 2012 when Eddie Lacy was drafted, this is a guy that Pete Carroll wanted. This is a guy the Seahawks wanted. And if it wasn't for the Packers taking him, I think Pete Carroll would have taken him, because they did want Eddie Lacy. And because the Packers went ahead and took Eddie Lacy before them, Seahawks went ahead and took Christian Michael. So, again, I'm not saying this is a move that's going to work, but, I mean, it does, you know, make it a bit more interesting to go into the season.
All right. I like it. I like the move for Seattle. And, ironically, we just heard this year that Marshawn Lynch wants back in the league, wants to play for the Raiders really bad. Dan, what's the probability that Marshawn Lynch does play in the NFL next season? Because I personally think it's very high. He left Seattle last year. I think he was very, 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 very disgruntled about not getting the ball from the 1 yard line for the touchdown in the Super Bowl win in Super Bowl 49.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely can see it happening. It's going to depend on Seattle. I mean, Seattle has this contract, so they're going to either have to say we're going to trade you, or we're going to release you. So it's really in their hands if he wants to play. And rumors are he's only willing to play for Oakland, so that's kind of tying his hands there. So I think a lot of balls might have to fall in order for that to happen. But I can see it happen, but I can also see him kind of just doing his own thing, kind of doing a Ricky Williams thing. I've seen him on some Travel Channel shows, eating some weird food. So he's definitely living the life. He was in the sand. He was doing some stuff. So he's out there living right now. So who knows if he'll be fully committed to coming back.
Yeah, and his own agent attests to that. I don't know what the hell he's going to do. He's so unpredictable, no one knows what Marshawn is going to do. So if his own agent is saying that, then who really knows? But I mention this because we do have a good mailbag question from Gil Savage Flint on the matter. He wants to know, Marshawn Lynch in Oakland, this is actually going to happen, or is Lynch just looking to taste the rainbow? Man, speaking of Skittles, though, I did see that relationship, like I said, did sour in Seattle, like some sour Skittles, over them failing to give them the ball in Super Bowl 49 and just running a ridiculous play, which Malcolm Butler earned a big-time paycheck off of. I knew Marshawn wasn't done. Like I said, after that was he was playing at too good a level. He just wasn't a washed-up running back. And like his own agent attests to, he's unpredictable. You don't know what he's going to do. I think he's had a year out of the league to heal his mind, heal his body, and I think that desire to really play football, particularly in your own backyard, basically of Oakland, is just really, really itching at him. So, I think he'll definitely be looked at, if not by Oakland, and if he does decide he wants to play in the NFL, then I think he will get a legitimate shot. And if he does actually end up playing for Oakland, then there goes Dan's prediction of DeAndre Washington being a top five running back next year. Orlando, what do you think about Marshawn and his future?
I think he's better off staying on top of Mount Everest on this National Geographic shows. I like Marshawn a lot. I really do. And it would be nice to see him come back. He's one of my favorite players. But it's hard to see him come back as a featured back, because the last 2-3 seasons he was in the league, he spent a lot of time on the injury side of the ball. You know, he was injured a lot. And that's when we saw Thomas Ross come into. And, you know, him going into Oakland as a featured back, I mean, it's kind of hard to believe that. So I'm going to have to go Dan's pick with the Oakland backfield there. I mean, you look at the AFC West as a whole, Kansas City's a tough defense. San Diego were a lot of close games, but they're a pretty good defense. And the same thing with the Denver Broncos. So, you know, for a guy like Lynch to come in, when's the last time he played a fully healthy season? Probably in that 2014 season when they went to the Super Bowl. So, you know, it's kind of hard to imagine a guy like Lynch just coming out of retirement, 30 years old, and going to a brutal AFC West that, you know, filled with some really good defenses. It's kind of hard to see him just jump into that, and especially with a new team. So it's not hard to see him make a comeback, but as far as a featured back, I can't see that.
And we'll see. But appreciate the question, Gil Savage Flint. Very hot topic of the last few days. It's growing in attention. So watch out for Marshawn Lynch and see where, if he does land in the NFL next season and actually plays. Let's stay out west and answer a question from Linda. 49ers, baby. What do you think the 49ers will do with the number 2 overall pick? Draft, trade, who, what, where? When? Why? Please. Baby. So, Dan, I'm going to go to our draft guru and expert. What are the 49ers looking to do with that number 2 pick?
Yeah, I mean, I've been hearing a lot of talk about them possibly trading down, accruing some picks. I mean, that's a roster depleted of talent. And with the new GM and John Lynch, Kyle Shanahan, head coach coming in, they're going to want to get their own guys. So if they can trade that number 2 pick for a haul, like you saw Tennessee grab last year and Cleveland and different teams over the past few years trade those high draft picks and get a haul of picks in return. So if they can do that, I see them trading down. But if they stick with that number 2 pick, I like a guy like Solomon Thomas, a defensive end out of Stanford. Before I even, you know, kind of predicted him to possibly go to the 49ers in my draft profile that I did on him, you know, he's a hybrid defensive end. He can fit in a 3-4-4-3 scheme, which is nice, that versatility. He's a beast. His game film is fun to watch. But I comped him to Justin Smith, who was a 49er legend, really. I mean, he's beloved in 49er nation, so I'm sure if they can draft someone similar to that who can give them that type of production, they definitely wouldn't mind having him as their anchor of that defensive line.
So you look at the top 5 or 6, 7, 8 picks or so of what's projected in the NFL draft. Of course, you got Solomon Thomas, which I guess I'm assuming he's definitely the number 2 asset behind Myles Garrett. Is that right, Dan? Is he clearly a number 2?
Yeah, I mean, of the team? It's definitely looking that way. I have him as my number two defensive end. Jonathan Allen, who I know you're a fan of, Brandon, I've seen his stock kind of fall. I mean, he has that that shoulder injury where it's similar to Shaq Lawson's from last year, who was drafted in the first round of the Buffalo Bills, didn't play a snap.
But if Miles Garrett or Solomon Thomas is not there, would you take Jonathan Allen if you were the Titans?
If your main goal is defensive end, I don't know if I would, to be honest with you, because it is such a deep draft for pass rush, and they have that second first round pick that they can still grab, you know.
And secondary too, there's so many DBs out there. You know, Adams, Hooker, Lattimore. You know, but San Francisco is in the same position. You know, so many good defensive assets out there, but they really need offense, right?
Yeah, I mean, they don't really. I think Brian Hoyer might be their only quarterback, or some obscure veteran is on their team. That's their only quarterback, I think, that they may have signed.
Well, they got Matt Barkley now, so the hometown kid.
Joy to the 49ers there. Yeah. That's great for them. Yeah, I mean, they really, outside of Carlos Hyde as an offensive weapon, they have Vance McDonald, who's a nice tight end piece to have. But, I mean, wide receivers, they're pretty thin. So who knows what they can do. That's why I would look for them to trade down and accrue more picks to kind of build that team up.
Yeah, they need to. They almost need to take the Cleveland Browns approach because they need so many weapons on offense. But honestly, right now, I wouldn't even look at quarterback, and I wouldn't stretch for a quarterback, definitely not in the first round and maybe not even in the second round, because if I'm okay with Brian Hoyer or Matt Barkley, because I'm just in the situation. So many teams think you need a really stud quarterback to have success, but when you're starting from in such a deep hole, forget the quarterback for a while. You got to give him weapons. You got to protect him, number one. Orlando, what do you think the 49ers should do?
Yeah, Brian Hoyer, quarterback, he's not the, you know, it's not the sexiest pick or the, you know, the guy in the roster, but I'll take Brian Hoyer compared to what he's done in the past. So I know they need to address a lot of key positions on their team, and I know quarterback is what they want a lot, but I think Solomon Thomas said number two. LA stay at number two. Again, I think that would know more if they were to trade down. But if they were to stick with the number two pick, I do think that they take Solomon Thomas. I just think he's just too much talent for them to pass up on.
Yep, I do think, Linda, they actually do end up keeping the pick and drafting probably Solomon Thomas, or maybe even one of those DBs like I mentioned. But I think they end up taking the pick and taking the better talent overall in the draft. But they do have a lot of work to do and definitely need help on the offensive side of the ball. I do believe that. So. But good luck to your 49ers. We'll be keeping an eye on them and see what Kyle Shanahan can build up there out west. And good luck to them. The next question comes from Todd DeVault and wants to know, I love the NFL draft. Every year it makes me think about busts. Who is the biggest draft bust in your mind? And in a part two, what bust were you shocked was actually a bust? For me, it was Danny Werfel, and he's going way back. The guy who was Tim Tebow before Tim Tebow was cool. I mean, that was a winner. Stat monster at Florida who loved the man upstairs a lot. So he's really kind of comparing him to Tim Tebow there. Well, now I got to thinking about this. I mean, number one, Todd went way back with Danny Werfel, but I'm thinking about number one and number one picks is Jamarcus Russell right off the top. I think all of us would agree with that. 25 career games, sacked 70 times in those 25 career games. His completion rate dropped to 48 in 2009, which was his last year with the Raiders. 23 interceptions in 25 games. The thing is, after that, he just got out of shape and couldn't even pass a tryout with any other team. So it was really amazing how bad he looked coming out of LSU in just two quick years. But then I also went way back on you just because I think Jamarcus Russell was the obvious one, but Kijana Carter from Penn State way back played 7 years but only started 14 games. He was the number one pick in, I think, like 1996. 1,100 yards and 20 TDs, never started another game outside his first 2 years in the NFL. So, again, number one pick coming out of Penn State, really hyped up, you know, worked his way in slowly but then just fell off and had no value after a mediocre second year in the NFL. But Dan, again, is our draft guru. He may go back to 1967, whoever the first round pick was then, and tell you who the busts were. Dan, what do you think about this question from Todd DeVault?
I love this question. Todd, this made my juices flow. I loved it. In regards to the, I guess, part one, which would be the biggest bust, I'm going with another Cincinnati Bengal, and that's Akili Smith, drafted third overall out of Oregon. I liked him a lot. You know, I was a huge fan of his, liked him in Madden. You know, I'd rock him out in Madden all the time. But when you look at his career stats, he only lasted 4 years, a total of 5 touchdown passes in his entire career, completion percentage of 46%. The dude was bad, like really bad. So he's number one on my bust list. Jamarcus Russell at least got some starts out of him. I mean, Akili Smith started 17 games in his over 4 seasons and accumulated 5 touchdown passes. That to me is just mind-blowingly terrible. And then in regards to a guy that I was shocked that was kind of a bust was Dez Bryant before Dez Bryant, and that's Rashawn Woods, who was a receiver out of Oklahoma State who was drafted towards the end of the first round by the 49ers a few years back. He was breaking records left and right in college. He was great. I thought he was going to be a phenomenal pro. He played a couple seasons, didn't barely catch a pass, and out of the NFL, so I was kind of surprised by that. I don't know if there were some off-the-field issues that I'm not aware of, but he was a talent with Oklahoma State, and when he was drafted in the first round, he never heard from him.
I mean, thinking of busts.
Yeah, good one. No, go ahead, Orlando.
I think to some of the most recent busts, because I know every year the draft just grows more and more. Looking at some of the recent guys, I mean, Robert Griffin III, obviously, is up there. You look at another guy like Justin Blackman, some of these guys. Robert Griffin III, unfortunately, he did have some wins under him. So we'll give him that. You know, in the first year, he took the Redskins to the playoffs in the wild card. But this is a guy who could just never not get right after that. And, you know, after countless chance after chance he's been gotten, especially recently in Cleveland, the guy just can't get it together, especially with the injuries. And Justin Blackman as well, a lot of, you know, they projected him to be one of the top 5 receivers at that time. And the guy just couldn't stay off the dope for whatever reason. Jamarcus,
stay off the weed,
exactly. And I mean, obviously, yeah, Jamarcus Russell. I mean, but that was the one that I had to bring up. Yeah, I hit it right there. And Trent Richardson, those are a couple. I mean, I'm just naming, supposed probably name one, but those are a couple that come to mind.
Well, it's fun playing this game because you start playing this game and everyone brings up names that you're like, oh, yeah, what the hell happened to that dude? And Orlando just mentioned one that I forgot about, Justin Blackman. Is he still on the Jaguars?
No, he's never even reapplied for reinstatement after he was suspended, which is crazy. He's completely gone off the deep end, kind of like I don't know if you remember from a few years ago, Titus Young. He was a receiver for the Lions who kind of went all insane, crazy, got arrested a few times for being naked in a store or something like that. So, yeah, I mean, it's
hopefully he found the help that he needed. That's sad.
Yeah, but Blackman never really heard from again. He's been eligible to reapply, and he just never has.
No, whatever he was smoking was, I think it was a little bit better, I guess, to him than going back to the NFL.
Well, I don't. No matter what your choice of drug is, you got to have money to buy those drugs. And I don't know. Maybe being in the NFL is not the best thing for him, because the more money you make, the more money you have for drugs. Maybe. So maybe God is leading him down the path he needs to be down. I don't know. But man, that is your NFL talk. That is your NBA talk. That is your March Madness talk for this podcast. We covered it all, guys. We only got a short period of time. You can't sit here and listen to us all night. I know a lot of you would like to, and we would probably even enjoy doing like an 8-hour podcast. We just can't do it. It's physically exhausting to do that much. So we cram as much into a short period of time as we can. But hey, it doesn't necessarily stop right here. Our website is booming. We got our third server in a year. All right, Dan? We are zooming now, third server in the last, 12 months or so. So all the articles are up there because Dan crashed the old server, version 2, V2, basically, with all his draft profiles that he's put out. So we have all of that on the website right now. Plus, you know what's going on right now, Dan, on the website that I saw this? And I know you saw it, but it's huge news. Bane versus Iron Fist.
Yeah, that's Elijah Bailey, one of our entertainment writers. Yeah, he spent almost a month writing that. And if you click on that, man, you're going to get a whole load of information you don't even want, but you need.
And, maybe you do.
And then you get to vote at the end of who would win this battle. And he lays it out for you. They have superpowers. And they have superpowers. I thought it was misspelled, but it was an actual word. I had to Google it when I was editing the piece because these superpowers are above our normal alphabet. So
and the superhero brackets going on now, that has been huge.
Superhero brackets, March Madness, you get to vote on your favorite superheroes, TV characters, movie characters, basically all of it. So check out our entertainment section, it's blowing up. Wrestling obviously coming back on My Fantasy Sports Talk, college basketball, NFL draft profiles, our draft show, that's something I'm really excited about. We're going to be live on the first round of the NFL draft, doing our own live draft show. And like I've said before, nobody wants to listen to Mel Kiper and his hair and Mike Mayock talk. And I don't have any hair, so you don't have to worry about that.
One less thing to worry about. You don't want to – what did you say last week, Dan? You don't want to lick burnt toast. Want to stick your head in a blender.
Yep, and you don't want to look at the bear claw of Mel Kiper all the time.
I mean, we got two guys on here with no hair, so it's even better.
And the world has never been sexier, at least for the 2 hours that we do this thing right here that we do on YouTube. So nothing to worry about. It's going to be a long and great night of us breaking down every single pick. And I'm telling you, I would put Dan Chalk's resume against all those guys because you can just look at his draft profile. And if you can only see our YouTube searches of what Dan is looking up and all the hours of film that he has actually looked at over the last couple of months, then you would know the dude knows what he is talking about. So can't miss this April 27th from 7 to 10 Eastern time for our live draft podcast. That's it for this week, folks. Next week, we'll have Sweet 16 reactions and Final Four predictions. Also, take a look at the NFL landscape and see if anything drastic has changed in that time. And we will also take a look at NBA seedings and let you know who is in the championship of the MyFantasySportsTalk.com NBA Fantasy League. Plus, we'll let you know who LeVar Ball has us talking about and talking about next week if he pops back in the conversation. So no telling. You never know. But just one thing for you guys at home to do this for me. Keep clicking. Keep listening. Keep watching every single week. You got you. Podcasting Network. You got WBLZ at WBLZSports.com. And, of course, our website, MyFantasySportsTalk.com. And here's the thing. Why go anywhere else for sports and entertainment? That's the bottom line. So come back, folks. Until next week, for Dan Shaw and Orlando Torres, this is Brandon Reed. See you then. Later.